The police in Glendale, California were sure that the man they had in jail was one of the worst serial killers of all time, maybe guilty of 200 murders. So why were they letting Efren Saldivar go free? The incredible story of the Saldivar murders is an example of a kind of serial killing that cops find nearly impossible to prove. Healthcare workers murdering patients. It happens more often than you think. And because these killers are so clever and their weapons so obscure, they often get away with it for years. That may be changing now, thanks in part to some tenacious investigators and a crime lab unlike any you've ever seen. But before we take you there, consider Efren Saldivar, a respiratory therapist whose patients died mysteriously until the cops made their own diagnosis, murder. Efren Saldivar certainly didn't seem like a killer. He was a 28-year-old respiratory therapist with a good reputation. But in 1998, there were rumors at Glendale's Adventist Medical Center that some patients were being murdered. The police were talking to employees, and they wanted to give Saldivar a lie detector test. Detectives John McKillop and Will Curry expected to interview Saldivar, clear him, and send him back to work.
As soon as I brought up the idea of taking a polygraph to him, he said he didn't want to take it. He wasn't refusing to take it. He just said he told me he'd fail it.
And then what did he tell you?
I asked him why, and he told me that 6 months after he started in his line of work, he killed his first patient.
He'd been at Adventist Medical Center for 9 years. Saldivar made a complete confession, but even so, they couldn't charge him.
In order to use a confession against somebody, you have to prove the case first. I mean, it's like being a pirate and being out there looking for treasure with shovels, but no map. We had no evidence, nothing. We just had a confession.
Saldivar said he used two drugs, Pavulan and succinyl choline chloride, to paralyze his victims and stop their breathing. But some experts said those drugs couldn't be traced after death, and even if they could, the detectives didn't know who the victims might be. Saldivar's patients were thought to have died of natural causes. With no known victims and no evidence, they literally had to kick Saldivar out of jail.
The guy didn't want to leave his cell. He was just, you know, thought we were sort of playing some cruel joke on him, telling him he could go home.
They may have let Saldivar go, but they wouldn't drop the case. The detectives set up an office next to the hospital, pulled in thousands of records, and asked Dr. Mark Nelson to look at the medical charts of more than 150 patients who died while Saldivar was on the job.
You're looking in the chart for someone who is getting along fairly well, and then
right.
Suddenly...
They're doing well, and then they crash. They're getting better, and they crash. Or they're about to be discharged home, and they crash. They're well 1 minute, they're dead the next. That's what we look at.
He found 50 candidates. They exhumed 20.
We knew what we were looking for. We just didn't know. We were told by many experts that it couldn't be found.
They were looking for two drugs, Pavulan and succinyl choline chloride. Doctors use them to paralyze the body in order to get a breathing tube down a patient's throat. The patient can't breathe unless he's on a respirator. These were the weapons, but many experts believed that they would vanish without a trace.
Experts in the field of forensic toxicology saying, you know, they're wasting their time. They're not going to find these drugs. You can't find them. They break down to what's naturally in your body. And the bodies have been in the ground for 2 years, you know. I mean, it was a completely, you know, insurmountable task.
So they brought what seemed impossible to the place that some cops have called the lab of last resort, the Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory in California, most famous for designing nuclear weapons.
We have the technology that no other forensics labs have.
Dr. Brian Andreessen is a chemist who founded the crime lab at Lawrence Livermore.
No one had ever really looked at aged autopsy tissues for ultra-low levels of drugs. And when they initially came to me, I learned the magnitude of the problem, and it was a big eye-opener for me.
Andreessen was presented with the bodies of the possible murder victims.
We just opened up the bodies and started collecting samples.
Samples from where?
All over the body, from thigh muscles all the way up to brain tissue.
And when Andreessen started testing those samples, sure enough, he found nothing. He even injected Pavulon into pig tissue, tested that, and still couldn't find it. He was looking for unimaginably tiny traces. Just look at this. That dark speck is one of the actual tissue samples from one of the victims in the Saldivar case.
Just this little bit at the end.
Yes, a little tiny bit at the end. But again, this is a few hundred micrograms, and our technology in forensics is sensitive down to a few single nanograms, 1,000 times more sensitive than that little spot right there.
Working 16-hour days for a month, he went through more than 200 varieties of chemical filters. Pavulon's fingerprint should show up on the screen as an unmistakable spike, but nothing was working. Then, on a hunch, he used a process originally designed to find the residue of chemical weapons. It was a failure in the weapons project, but Andreessen tried it anyway. He tested six patients, got nothing, and then number seven revealed the Pavulon spike. In all, Andreessen found six patients poisoned with Pavulon.
And we were just in shock. I mean, it was a combination of shock and relief. If we found the drug, it was conclusive. There was a homicide.
It had been nearly 3 years since Saldivar's first confession. Saldivar was so sure they wouldn't find the evidence, he never strayed very far from Glendale. They arrested him again, he confessed again, and now he's in prison for life. We wondered what motivates hospital killers like Saldivar, wondered how they get away with murder for so long. Saldivar didn't want to talk to us, but we did find another man who may have killed nearly as many patients.
You pleaded guilty to murdering how many people?
I was convicted for 37.
We found Donald Harvey in an Ohio prison where he's serving several life sentences for those 37 murders. But he admitted to us, truth be told, that there were many more killings than that.
37 represents most? Half?
Roughly half.
Roughly half?
Yes.
How did you kill them?
With lack of oxygen, cut off the oxygen supply. Morphine, I used cyanide, I used arsenic, I used different means, whatever I had at hand.
Harvey was a nurse's assistant in Kentucky and Ohio. He was convicted of murder in 1987, but he says that he started killing nearly two decades before.
How do you think you got away with this for 17 years?
Most of the doctors would be so overworked, so busy, that a patient could die and the family doctor would not come in and pronounce the person dead. They'd have a resident do that. They just pronounce them dead and send them straight to the funeral home.
You thought it was the perfect crime?
That, I felt the doctors go and spend all these years in school, and they'd always come in with this kind of superior attitude, you know, I know everything, but yet they didn't know nothing.
It's hard to know what drives killers like Harvey. He told us he was a mercy killer, putting patients out of their misery. But he also said the first patient he killed had just made him angry. There's clearly more to his motive than mercy.
Once these people died, what was the feeling inside you?
First of all, I didn't get caught. Second of all, I was released from, you know, from the pain.
Sense of satisfaction.
Right.
Sense of control.
Control.
Sense of power.
Well, control and power is about the same thing, isn't it? The way I look at it. If you're controlling something, you got the power to do it, so.
In his first confession, Saldivar said he paralyzed his patients to end their suffering.
How are you really relieving suffering by paralyzing somebody to make it where they can't breathe, but they're still conscious, wondering what's going on, their eyes are open? For a couple of minutes, maybe doctors and nurses are coming in and saying, oh, poor Mr. So-and-so, he just expired. And here's the paralyzed patient, fully conscious with his eyes open, going, hey, I'm not dead. But he can't move and he can't say it. To me, that's the worst suffering.
How many died that way? Saldivar says he lost count at 60. In all, McKillop and Curry believe he killed between 100 and 200 people. Saldivar went to prison last year, but before that, he admitted to McKillop and Curry that he had a secret motive, too.
And in the end, he gave us the motive.
And it was what?
It was workload. There was no other reason. He would kill patients that would cause he or the hospital staff a lot of work. And that's how he just more or less thin out the crowd.
Dr. Nelson says that, believe it or not, it's a common motive. And he points to the recent case of a nurse named Kristen Gilbert.
For instance, Kristen Gilbert case, there was a patient in the ICU, and that was the only patient in the ICU, and she told her supervisor, I would like to leave at 9 o'clock because I've got something I want to do. The supervisor said, you can't go, we still got a patient. And she said, well, what if he dies by 9 o'clock? Can I go? And she said yes, and the patient died before 9 o'clock.
Nurse Kristen Gilbert was convicted in 2001 of killing four patients, and there have been other recent cases. Orville Lynn Majors, also a nurse, was convicted in 1999 of killing six, and Dr. Michael Swango was convicted of murdering four, but suspected of dozens more.
How often are we running into these cases in the United States?
Right now, they're happening at a rate of about once every 2 to 5 years.
I'll tell you, that's a little more common than I expected.
Right. But during that 2 to 5 years, how many millions of people have been admitted to a hospital? Many millions get admitted to tens of thousands of hospitals, and every 2 to 5 years, one bad apple pops up.
You notice how when individuals classified as white, when they start talking about other white criminals, they get right fruity. Got the bad apple. You talking about killing of Eric Garner? You talking about the killing of Sandra Bland? Michael Brown Jr.? Tamir Rice? We got the bad apple. White race soldiers killing with a badge. Could be white race soldiers killing with a stethoscope or syringe, but they get right fruity. I say the orchard is bad if you got that many bad apple. Like, man, what is up with the orchard? Metaphor. Katherine Massey, book club, context of white supremacy. Third installment on James B. Stewart's Blind Eye. Many reasons why I wanted to read this book. That audio segment, I love me some 60 Minutes. Isn't that fogey? That's with like the geriatrics. President Trump, people his age, I love me some 60 Minutes. Man, they had awesome content on everything we've been reading this year, pretty much. They had Jeffrey Dahmer, Columbine. That was 60 Minutes from 20 years ago, 2003. Now, they were specifically, that segment mostly was talking about Efren Salvador. Looks like he'd be classified as a white man to me. I don't have any confusion about that. You can look at his image or what have you. That was the person that they were talking about for the most part, where they said, man, he confessed to killing, but we couldn't prove it, so we had to let him go. Go and do, get the evidence, see if we could actually prove that, yes, he did indeed poison these people, and then we can lock him up and convict him. But see, they pivoted out. They spent most of the time talking to him. We heard some of the same things. Let's say, felt like I was God. I'm in control. I'm a white man, white woman, in a white lab coat. I got the power of life and death. But they pivoted. They didn't just talk about Efren Salvador. They pivoted and they said, oh yeah, we've heard this a few times. We heard old Kristen Gilbert. I'd never heard of her before myself. That's when you hear that. That was a white woman. And she said, hey, man, I got things to do, man. Look here. Can I get out of there? Oh, no. Whoa. Patient D. Let me see. So if she died by 9, I'm out of here? Okay, let me get this sign. We got things to do. Come on. I hadn't even heard of her. Then they pivot out. Donald Harvey, classified as a white man. They went right on down the road. Orville Lynn Majors, I hadn't heard of him either, classified as a white man. And then even, oh, yeah. Dr. Michael Swango. Now, they got to the end there on 60 Minutes. They say, now, dang, how common is this? Well, you got white man, white woman. Don't you think I didn't pause for a second? Kevin Dutton and all these other old so-called experts have sat around and told us that, hey, patriarchy, these white men are the racists. These white dudes are the psychopaths. Man, we toss old Lucy Letby in there, and it seems like we got quite a few white women out here doing psychopathic things, too. Anyway, they got to the end of the segment, and they said, so about how common do you think this is, the healthcare serial killer? And I said, oh, looks like the bad apple pops up about every 2 to 5 years. Now, I suspect that that might be a lie. Might be more often than that, but whatever. Even if it's every 2 years. And you're talking about Swango and these folks, we don't even know how many people they killed. 60, 70, who knows? God works in mysterious ways. Isn't that what they say? Man, I do not ever. Now, I said this before. Maybe we should have read this book right at the beginning of COVID. Hey, well, maybe not. Nobody would have wanted the vaccine. I'm going to say this, though. I do not ever, ever, ever want to hear the name Nurse Rivers again. We read Harriet A. Washington. We had James Jones on the program to talk about his book, Bad Blood, recognized as the preeminent book on the Tuskegee syphilis experiment in the archives. I do not ever want to hear anybody mention her name. Black people might not want to go to the... Man, please. Let's start with the white women. Kristen Gilbert. I got things to do, man. Sitting around here, changing bedpans and such. 9 p.m., you are out of... Yep, flatline, gotta go. That's why I don't want to go and get the COVID-19 vaccine. Donald Harvey. Orville Lynn Majors. Efren Salvador. Michael Swango. Lucy Letby. Harold Shipman. That's why I don't want to go and get the vaccine. That's why I'm distrustful of white people, white women, white men, white med school students in a white lab coat with a needle and a syringe. That's why. I read James B. Stewart. Blind Eye. Katherine Massey Book Club. Audio segment 1.
On February 9th, the day after the meeting, Goodman began what would prove to be a pivotal investigation of Swango's activities. His investigation had three components. At 3:30 p.m., he interviewed Cooper. Next, he reviewed the files of 7 patients who had died since Swango began his neurosurgery rotation. Last, he considered the results of a blood test on Cooper. He did not interview either of the residents, Freeman or Brakel, who responded to the code on Cooper. Had he interviewed Brakel, he would have learned more about Swango's involvement in Ruth Barrick's death the same day, since Brakel had responded to Barrick's code as well. Nor did Goodman interview any of the nurses who'd witnessed the events, or the orderly who discovered the syringe, or Utz, Cooper's roommate. He didn't ask to see the syringe, still in Nurse Moore's custody. He didn't speak to any witnesses to any of the patients' deaths, such as Nurse Ritchie. No autopsies or physical tests were ordered for any of the possible victims, Nor were any experts in toxicology or anesthesia consulted for possible explanation of the deaths and of Cooper's apparent paralysis. While Goodman did not purport to be a trained investigator, the extremely limited scope of his inquiry is hard to comprehend, unless he had already largely concluded that Swango was innocent, and that the nurse's grapevine, as he put it, was largely to blame for the rumors sweeping the hospital. These were sentiments he had expressed from the outset. The following statements appear in a memorandum Goodman wrote the next day, summarizing the interview with Cooper. Someone was standing by the bed and injected something into the IV. Blond, short, unable to see face, yellow pharmacy jacket. Goodman's principal reaction to the interview seems to have been distress that Cooper was spreading stories that were agitating other patients. He called Cramp, the hospital chief, at 4:30 p.m. to complain that rumors about Swango were rampant on the floor, and to say he was moving Cooper to a private room to stop them. Although Cramp objected, Goodman did so. He also ordered that only Amy Moore, the head nurse, would be allowed contact with Cooper. This move, too, was intended to contain her inflammatory allegations. That Saturday morning, the initial group involved in the matter met to hear Goodman's report and conclusions. Three important people joined this meeting. Holder, Sigournis, and Michael Whitcomb, the hospital medical director, a close friend and protege of Sigournis. Although Dixon and others had urged that the university president, Edward Jennings, and Richard Jackson, the vice president, attend, Sigournis had decided that there was no need. To Dixon's amazement, Goodman was even more dismissive of the allegations against Swango than he had been at the first meeting. His interview with Cooper, he assured the group, had gone a long way toward eliminating the possibility that Swango had been involved in foul play of any kind. Goodman reported that Cooper had identified the alleged assailant as a female, and neither a nurse nor physician on the hospital staff. Since his notes also indicated the person was wearing a yellow pharmacy jacket, he concluded the suspect was probably a woman pharmacy technician, and he had already determined that there was no one who fit that description. Virtually everything about Goodman's conclusions and interview with Cooper is puzzling. Cooper insisted she never described her assailant as a female. Indeed, in her numerous other accounts of the incident, Cooper said consistently that she couldn't see the person's face, and whenever she identified her attacker's sex, she said he was male. In her first handwritten note, she referred to the assailant as he. Nor, she maintained, did she ever mention anything about a yellow pharmacy jacket. Her roommate did refer to a yellow tourniquet. Goodman said that Nurse Moore was a witness to the interview, and, by implication, would support his account. However, Cooper herself said she remembered only that Goodman was present. Moore declined my requests for comment. In any event, at the time, participants in the meeting had only Goodman's version. Goodman also reported on his review of the files of patients who died. While he conceded that 7 deaths in a little more than 2 weeks was abnormally high, he said the norm was 2 or 3. He said that all the patients had been extremely ill, and that the deaths were clearly explainable medically. As another doctor put it, sometimes the grim reaper of death just sweeps through a hospital. While Goodman also conceded that Swango had been present when at least half the patients died, this was only to be expected, given that he was an intern assigned to the floor, working long hours. The only death that caused Goodman any concern at all, he said, was that of Cynthia Ann McGee, the young gymnast. Goodman noted that she had been improving, and that the sudden death had come as a surprise. But an autopsy had been performed, and Goodman said he'd been told the cause of death was a pulmonary embolism. Such embolisms aren't uncommon in cases where patients have been transported, as McGee had been from Illinois, he explained. Goodman's colleague and mentor, Dr. Hunt, said he too had reviewed the patient files and seconded Goodman's conclusions. McGee's autopsy results, in fact, cite cardiopulmonary arrest due to incipient pneumonia as the cause of death. There is no mention of a pulmonary embolism. Finally, the group discussed the results of the blood test on Cooper. But no such blood test results were ever found in Cooper's medical file. It is at least possible that the blood test ordered by Freeman was never administered, or that the results were lost. The notes of the meeting don't make clear whether Goodman reviewed the results himself or relied on a hearsay report that they were normal. In either case, the results may have come from a blood test given Cooper when she entered the hospital. They were in her file and, not surprisingly, showed nothing suspicious. That was the end of the investigation, as far as Goodman was concerned. The group did consider some troublesome evidence that seemed to call Goodman's conclusions into question. Dixon, for example, circulated the written eyewitness accounts of the Cooper incident she'd collected from the nurses, including Carolyn Beery, who had been only several feet from Swango when she saw him inject something into Cooper's IV line. She also showed the meeting participants Cooper's handwritten notes. Dr. Carey reported on his conversation with Swango, in which he denied injecting anything into Cooper's IV, a statement also in conflict with Beery's observations. But the doctors, especially Goodman and Whitcomb, dismissed their significance, noting disdainfully that Beery was a student nurse. "What does a student nurse know?" one of the doctors asked, to knowing snickers around the table. The comment left Dixon quietly seething. Swango's file was reviewed, and the group discussed the evidence suggesting that he had attitudinal problems. Carey mentioned the residents' reports that Swango had weird ideas about death, that he was fascinated by the Nazis, and that his work was substandard. But Cincione's sketchy notes of the meeting conclude only that this discussion shed no light on the situation at hand. Nor could any support for the proposition that a pharmaceutical technician was the culprit be produced. Boyanowski, the administrator, had investigated that possibility, and there were no blonde female technicians. Cooper hadn't been scheduled to receive any medication during the relevant time period. The group also discussed at some length what might have caused Cooper's respiratory failure, a fact which could hardly be ascribed to nurses' paranoia. Potassium was mentioned as a chemical that, when injected, can easily cause cardiac arrest. But the doctors pointed out that Cooper didn't suffer a heart attack. She experienced a respiratory failure. Her IV line had been discarded, so no tests on it were possible. Curiously, the mention of possible tests on the IV line triggered no mention of the syringe by Goodman, although he had been told of its existence by Nurse Moore. The group concluded that the cause of Cooper's seizure was probably unknowable. Then the lawyers weighed in. Without knowing the cause of Cooper's code, Cincione told the group, they had no legal basis for accusing Swango of a criminal act, or, for that matter, even removing him from the intern program. But while the lawyers seemed to have been focusing on Swango's rights and the potential liability of Ohio State, they seemed to have given no consideration to an Ohio statute that requires any physician to report any serious physical harm to persons that he knows or has reasonable cause to believe resulted from an offense of violence. In any event, these requirements were never mentioned at any of the group's meetings, despite the presence of two lawyers, Holder and Cincione. The meeting lasted about 3 hours. At its conclusion, Zagornis ordered that Swango be returned to the hospital, but watched closely. He asked Dr. Whitcomb to conduct a quiet inquiry into the matter and report his findings at another meeting in 3 days. At least some participants understood that the report was to be in writing. Both Dixon and Boyanowski objected, again arguing that the hospital couldn't effectively investigate itself, and that there was enough evidence to justify notification of the campus police. But Zagornis disagreed, no doubt in part because he was steeped in the medical profession's tradition of peer review, in which only other doctors are deemed competent to evaluate a fellow physician. Dixon, increasingly troubled by the direction of the inquiry, asked if she could assist Whitcomb by at least being present at interviews with the nurses. Zagornis said no. As Ohio State's medical director, Whitcomb held the number two medical position in the hospital, just under Zagornis. Like his boss, Whitcomb was an Ohio native and graduate of Ohio State, though he attended medical school at the University of Cincinnati. He worked at Walter Reed Army Hospital before returning to Ohio State in 1974. He was largely given responsibility for the investigation by virtue of his position as medical director. And because he was a pulmonologist, or lung specialist, it made some sense to assign him to investigate what appeared to be a respiratory failure. But Whitcomb looked terrible, as if he hadn't had much sleep. It hadn't surprised anyone that he couldn't be located in time for the first meeting. It was much discussed in the hospital that he had been having an affair with his secretary and was involved in a messy divorce. At the meeting, Whitcomb's hands were visibly trembling, so much so that Dixon later asked if he was suffering from some neurological condition. He later publicly acknowledged a drinking problem. Some who felt Swango should be vigorously investigated were dismayed that Whitcomb was put in charge, and their concerns were soon borne out, for Whitcomb's investigation was even more cursory than Goodman's. He spoke to Goodman and reviewed his notes, interviewed Beery, the student nurse, and significantly interviewed Swango. He did little else. Incredibly, he may not even have interviewed Rena Cooper, relying instead on Goodman's notes. Cooper later insisted that Whitcomb never interviewed her. Whitcomb kept no notes of his investigation and prepared no written conclusions. He delivered his report orally on February 14, 1984, to the same audience, which included Zagornis and Holder. Whitcomb concluded that no one in the hospital fit the description of a blonde female wearing a yellow pharmacy jacket. For all practical purposes, that description ruled out Swango as a suspect. In any event, Cooper's observations weren't reliable. She was no doubt confused, he said, which wasn't surprising since she had been given an anesthetic for her surgery earlier that day. Utz, the roommate, was also unreliable, as Hunt had earlier noted, because she had a brain tumor. Whitcomb hadn't interviewed her either, but he did go over her patient file. During Whitcomb's interview, Beery, the student nurse, had softened her earlier account. Under what must have felt like cross-examination by Whitcomb, Beery acknowledged that she was not certain she actually saw a syringe in Swango's hand. This, Whitcomb maintained, was inconsistent with her earlier statement that it appeared that Swango had injected something into Cooper's IV. Because of this, Whitcomb told the group that Beery's identification testimony was shaky, noting that she had been in the room only a short time. As he had suspected, she was an unreliable witness, and her statement should be discounted accordingly. Thus, Beery's statement in every interview that she had seen Swango in Cooper's room and had been only a few feet away was also discarded as unreliable. In diagnosing the cause of Cooper's respiratory arrest, Whitcomb identified the fact that she shook the bed rails as all but incontrovertible evidence of a seizure followed by paralysis. The possibility that Cooper could have rattled the rails before a paralyzing drug took full effect does not appear to have been considered. Whitcomb had spoken briefly to Dr. George Paulson, a neurologist at Ohio State, who said that it was possible for a seizure to be followed by paralysis. By contrast, drugs such as muscle relaxants might cause paralysis, but not a seizure. On that basis, and without speaking to any other specialists, such as anesthesiologists, Whitcomb diagnosed Cooper's problem as grand mal, a severe form of epilepsy, characterized by seizures and loss of consciousness, but not paralysis. Whitcomb told the group he'd interviewed Swango, and that Swango had given him a version of the slippers story, in which Cooper had complained that her feet were cold. However, Whitcomb later told police an entirely different story, that Swango told him he was in the room to draw blood. Nonetheless, Swango's account appears to have been accepted as credible, even as Beery's and Cooper's versions were dismissed as unreliable and confused. That was the end of Whitcomb's report. As Hunt later summed up the evidence, "All we have is a crazy patient who had an unusual episode and a nurse who saw something. Is that enough to prove anything?" Zagornis ordered that Swango, who had already returned to his work in the hospital, should resume his internship. The residents who worked with him in Rhodes Hall should be told that there wasn't any evidence against him, but that he should be nonetheless closely observed. The nurses, on the other hand, should be told only that Swango had been exonerated. And other doctors, including those on Swango's future rotations, would be told nothing. On Segordis's orders, there would be no further inquiry or investigation into the matter, and the police would be told nothing of the incident or the sudden increase in deaths. Dixon had by now fallen into stunned silence. Swango's accusers were all female nurses, his defenders male doctors. She was convinced that the entire point of the so-called investigation had been to exonerate Swango and thereby avoid any liability or embarrassment to the university. She had tried to see the patient files herself. She was denied access. She felt it would now be impossible to observe Swango closely in the hospital. There was too much to do, and too few doctors who had been alerted to Swango's suspicious activities to keep him under close surveillance, especially if the nurses and most of the doctors were kept in the dark. Still, she felt she had done what she could, at considerable personal risk. Now that Swango was back at work, and she had emerged as the strongest advocate for his dismissal, she thought it likely that someone on the medical staff would tell Swango. She was afraid to walk her dog at night alone, even in the safe neighborhood where she lived. She was afraid Swango would kill her. Carolyn Beery, the discredited student nurse, was also frightened and tried to avoid Swango. She and the other nurses usually brought bag lunches to work, which they labeled with their names and kept in a refrigerator. "Who's been messing with my lunch?" Beery asked a group of nurses one day, explaining that for several days it had been obvious that her food had been rearranged in the bag. Then she started to feel nauseated and developed headaches. She thought she might be pregnant, but three separate pregnancy tests were negative. After several weeks, when Swango left the neurosurgery rotation, her symptoms eased. She wondered if she was just being paranoid. Dr. Carey met with all the residents on the rotation remaining on Swango's schedule. He told them he was worried about Swango, that he wanted them to watch him closely and report to me any untoward events, any patients that had complications or difficulties that weren't expected. As he later put it, "Our intent was to do everything possible to protect people from harm and get him out the door at the end of the year without risk that a court would order us to reappoint him." On the same day as the meeting in which Swango was exonerated, Charlotte Warner, a 72-year-old leukemia patient, had a routine splenectomy performed by Dr. Mark Cooperman. The operation went well, and she recovered sufficiently to be transferred out of intensive care to room 968 in Doane Hall. Swango began working in Doane Hall on February 18th as part of his general surgery rotation. The next day, Cooperman met with Warner, found his patient to be doing very well, and talked with her about when she wished to be released from the hospital. That night, a nurse found her slumped on the floor by her bed. She was dead. An autopsy concluded she had suffered massive and unexplained blood clots all over her body, including the liver, lungs, kidneys, and left coronary artery. Dr. Cooperman was mystified and upset. As he later put it, "Basically what happened is she had developed clots in the arteries in her heart, in the vessels to the intestine, in the vessels to her kidneys, to her liver, and to her lungs. And I could never understand why this thing would have happened to somebody who had undergone a straightforward surgical procedure 5 days earlier and was walking around, having no problems." That same month, while Swango was in general surgery, he examined another surgical patient, Evelyn Perenni, with her attending physician, Dr. Carey. Later, the chief surgical resident, Gary Birkin, was urgently summoned to Perenni's bedside. She was bleeding all over her body, even from her eyes. As Dr. Birkin noted, her coagulation was off the wall, as if she had been bitten by a poisonous snake, such as a cobra. On the afternoon of February 20th, Mary Popko, came to visit her 22-year-old daughter, Anna May, who had undergone intestinal surgery for a deformed bowel. She was sitting with her daughter when Swango asked her to leave the room so he could give Anna May an injection to raise her blood pressure. Popko asked to remain so she could hold her daughter's hand. Swango refused, and she reluctantly left the room. Later that afternoon, Swango summoned Popko to a small conference room. He leaned back and put his feet on the table. "She's dead now," Swango said of Popko's daughter. "You can go look at her." Popko later complained about what she considered Swango's inappropriate comments and demeanor. "It seemed like it lifted his ego or something," she said of her daughter's death. "He just seemed so happy." Despite Dr. Carey's warning, none of the residents who had been alerted about Swango reported anything unusual. Swango completed his general surgery rotation, and in April moved to Children's Hospital for his pediatrics rotation. Swango had often mentioned to his fellow interns and residents how much he loved fried chicken. And one night he offered to get Kentucky Fried Chicken for the residents on duty with him. Thomas Vara, the senior resident, said that would be fine, but suggested, instead of getting separate boxes, why don't you get a big bucket for all of us to eat? "No, no," Swango said. "Let's keep it separate." He insisted on taking everyone's chicken and drink order. He returned with the orders about 5 p.m. "It's extra spicy chicken," Swango told Ed Hashimoto, one of the residents, as he gave him his food. That was news to Hashimoto. He knew that Kentucky Fried offered extra crispy chicken, but he'd never heard of extra spicy. Vara, Hashimoto, and a third resident, Douglas Hess, ate the chicken. About 3 hours later, all three fell violently ill, with fever, nausea, and vomiting that lasted over a week. As Vara later described it, "It's as sick as I've ever been. We were sick there at the hospital. The other guys were, Jesus, like in the operating room, vomiting in their masks and stuff. That's how bad it was." When the doctors later discussed the episode, they thought maybe they'd suffered a violent reaction to something in the chicken. But then they tended to discount their own theory. After all, Swango, too, had eaten Kentucky Fried Chicken. He hadn't been sick at all. Cooper, the elderly, born-again Christian whose brush with death had triggered the investigation of Swango, recovered from her back surgery and mysterious respiratory arrest without further incident. Before she was released, the hospital prepared a written discharge summary, which became a part of her permanent hospital record, something that would be produced in the event of any lawsuit. The summary contains a description of the Swango incident. Postoperatively, during the evening of surgery, the patient had a witnessed pulmonary arrest. She was noted to have seizure-like activity just prior to this arrest. When the patient received adequate oxygenation via endotracheal intubation, she was awakened and was intact neurologically. However, her sensorium was noted to be unusual, in that she had apparent paranoid ideation as to the cause of her respiratory arrest. The patient gave indication that she entertained some paranoid ideation regarding the cause of her respiratory arrest and felt that it may be due to unnamed person or persons. The patient was carefully observed for further psychological parameters of this nature. In other words, in the official opinion of the hospital that had treated her and where she nearly died, Cooper was mentally unstable. Paranoid. Chapter 4. The Residency Review Committee at Ohio State met in late February 1984 to consider Swango's status. At the end of his neurosurgery rotation earlier that month, Dr. Carol Miller, who despite supervising Swango's work claimed she was never told of the Cooper incident and investigation, had written a letter to Dr. Hunt, her future husband, concluding that Swango didn't demonstrate the qualities required of a neurosurgeon. She based her assessment on Swango's failure to inspire confidence in patients and other staff members, rather than on any specific incident. Dr. Ferguson, who had given Swango such a negative evaluation in the transplant rotation, went so far as to write a letter urging Swango's firing after he heard reports about the Cooper affair. As a result, the committee voted not to continue Swango's residency when he completed his internship at the end of June. But in keeping with Zagornis's orders, and out of fear that Swango might sue Ohio State, he was allowed to complete his internship and continue his work in the university hospitals. Dr. Hunt notified Swango of the committee's decision by letter dated March 2nd. But just 5 days after the letter rescinding Swango's residency appointment, three doctors on the university's medical faculty submitted recommendations on his behalf to the Ohio State Medical Board, to which Swango had applied for a permanent license to practice medicine. Two of these certificates of recommendation were made on a standard form supplied by the medical board. One was from Dr. Whitcomb, who had been in charge of the hospital investigation of Swango. He rated Swango's medical knowledge and technique, his ability to work well with peers and medical staff, and his relationship with patients all as good. Whitcomb left blank the space for personal comments, evaluation, and recommendation. The other recommendation was submitted by Dr. Gary Birkin, who had treated the patient with the mysterious bleeding. In the same categories, he rated Swango as excellent, excellent, and exemplary. The third recommendation was submitted by Dr. Carey, the head of surgery, who was also involved in the hospital's investigation. The form he used differed slightly from the other two. He rated Swango as good in the three areas mentioned. But in the space for comments, he said he was recommending Swango with reservations. This triggered an inquiry from the medical board in May, and Carey elaborated briefly on his recommendation in a letter dated June 5th. He wrote that while Swango had completed his internship at Ohio State, he had not been appointed to a second-year residency. Carey also wrote, "There was a suggestion concerning a patient's demise with regard to Dr. Swango having been in attendance proximate to the demise. This was investigated rather thoroughly, and Dr. Swango was exonerated." Though he didn't mention the patient by name, Carey must have been referring to Cooper, even though she didn't die, since none of the deaths linked to Swango had been investigated at all, let alone thoroughly. Carey's letter went on to say that Swango's performance had been substandard, that he had difficulty relating to paramedical personnel, and that he did not relate well to nurses and other hospital employees. Carey's letter thus reduced Swango's trouble at Ohio State largely to an issue of personality differences with paramedics and nurses. Hardly sufficient grounds to deny an otherwise qualified doctor a medical license. Virtually all of Carey's major assertions are, at the least, open to question. Cooper didn't die, but survived as an eyewitness. Swango was more than a bystander who was proximate to the incident. He was alleged to have caused it. The investigation wasn't thorough, and Swango was hardly exonerated. Even Zagornis had ordered that Swango be watched closely. Carey himself had told the residents he was worried about Swango. When I asked him about this, Carey said he had no recollection of the letter, but said that the people who read these would know that he was trying to warn them about Swango. The later Ohio State investigation concluded that Dr. Carey cannot be faulted for his handling of the recommendation to the state medical board. Despite Carey's reservations, the letter did nothing to deter the Ohio State Medical Board. In September 1984, it granted Swango's application and licensed him to practice medicine in Ohio. At the Ohio State Hospitals that summer, head nurse Amy Moore was going through her desk when she came across the syringe, still wrapped in a paper towel, that Joe Risley had found in room 966. The night of Cooper's respiratory arrest. Several months had passed since those terrifying events, but the discovery brought back bad memories of the whole affair. Moore couldn't understand why no one had seemed interested in the syringe, which she and the other nurses had been so careful to preserve. She told Dr. Goodman about it in their meeting, but he never mentioned it to her again. She had never been asked for it in the course of any investigation. Then she heard that Swango had been cleared. Moore was about to dispose of the thing, but for some reason she hesitated. She turned to another nurse and said she was going to throw the syringe away. "Do you think it's okay?" "Well, sure," the nurse replied. "It's gone now. It's over with." Moore dropped the syringe into a waste container. In July, Swango moved back to his hometown of Quincy, as he had during other intervals in his career. He told his mother and relatives that he hadn't liked the doctors he was working with at Ohio State, and as a result had left his residency there. He planned to apply for a medical license in Illinois, and in the meantime work as a paramedic for a few months before resuming his medical career. He was immediately hired by the Adams County Ambulance Corps, where he had worked the previous spring and part-time while he was at Quincy College. Though his hours were unpredictable and he often worked weekends, he frequently made the 8-hour drive to Columbus so he could see his girlfriend, Rita Dumas, and her children. As in the past, he managed to function on amazingly little sleep. He once mentioned that he'd made the long drive to Columbus, visited Dumas for just an hour, and then driven back and reported for work, all without any sleep. Quincy had changed little since Swango's childhood, or for that matter since its heyday as a Mississippi River port in the mid-19th century. Main Street, its central thoroughfare, runs through a National Historic District lined with stately mansions built by riverboat captains and early industrialists. Swango rented an apartment on 18th Street, just north of Main, at the upstairs rear of an attractive older brick house. It had one bedroom and a screen porch. It was within walking distance of Quincy's two hospitals, Blessing and St. Mary's. Though Quincy had a population of just over 40,000, its distance from any major city, Springfield was 2 hours away, had made it a regional medical center, serving a large rural area. The ambulance corps was headquartered at Blessing Hospital, in a suite adjacent to the hospital's emergency room. The paramedics shared a central room with a large round table, comfortable chairs and a television, a kitchen and bathroom, and several sleeping rooms. Paramedics worked 24-hour shifts, responding to ambulance calls whenever they came in, and often ate and slept at the hospital. Since they spent so much time together, they were a close-knit group, drawn together by a shared temperament that thrived on the crisis, violence, mayhem, and serious accidents that trigger ambulance calls. The work required a strong stomach. The paramedics' demeanor could at times seem vulgar and coarse to outsiders, and they often indulged in black humor to relieve the pressure of their work. Lonnie Long, who was in charge of the paramedics and who hired Swango, was a guns and weapons enthusiast. Copies of Soldier of Fortune and the National Rifle Association magazine were often lying about the paramedics' quarters. Still, even by the standards of paramedics, Swango was considered bizarre. Nearly everyone knew him from his previous stint with the Corps. An exception was Mark Krzysztofczyk. Somewhat soft-spoken, dark-haired, and nice-looking, Krzysztofczyk was 27 and had graduated from SIU before moving to Quincy in 1982. He wondered why a resident at a big hospital like Ohio State would be coming to work as a paramedic in Quincy. "Wait till you meet Swango," his co-workers told him when they learned their former colleague would be returning in July. "He's different." But when Krzysztofczyk asked why, they just grinned and shook their heads. "You'll see." If anything, the qualities that had made Swango different were now even more pronounced. The paramedics who had worked with him before noticed he was restless, on edge, constantly pacing around the room. He rarely sat down and relaxed with the other paramedics. He kept saying he wished something would happen so he could get on the ambulance. Still, they felt he was an effective paramedic and admired his medical degree and hospital experience, which put him on a different plane educationally from his colleagues. Long, in particular, told Swango that he envied him his education and internship, and warned Swango not to forget the paramedics when he resumed his career as a doctor. Long believed that most doctors had swelled heads and egos. Soon after Swango started work, he ran into Jim Daniels, a fellow graduate of the SIU Medical School and Quincy College, who'd been a year behind him at SIU. Daniels was now doing his internship at Blessing Hospital and was assigned to the emergency room for his first rotation, just as Swango had been at Ohio State. "I thought you were a neurosurgeon," Daniels said. "No," Swango answered. "It didn't work out." Daniels thought Swango might elaborate, but he said nothing further. Swango was similarly vague with Krzysztofczyk, who was often his partner on ambulance runs. Krzysztofczyk also wondered what his fellow paramedics had been talking about when they warned him about Swango. All that struck Krzysztofczyk about him in the first weeks they worked together were Swango's beaver cleaver, all-American looks, and how hard he was willing to work. He always volunteered for extra shifts. As if their long hours weren't enough, even when he was off duty, Swango monitored ambulance calls with a shortwave radio, and then would show up at the scenes of emergencies, sometimes even before the ambulance arrived. When he wasn't on an emergency run or visiting his girlfriend, he seemed to be exercising. Krzysztofczyk often saw him jogging in one of his old Marine sweatshirts. Gradually, however, Krzysztofczyk began to understand what his co-workers had meant when they said Swango was different. Perhaps in the nearly all-male, gun-and-violence-oriented atmosphere of the ambulance corps, Swango simply felt freer to express the kinds of interests that had surfaced only intermittently in college, at SIU, and at Ohio State. In any event, he now revealed far more about his fantasy life and fascination with violence than he ever had before. Krzysztofczyk noticed that his colleagues seemed extremely excited when they reached an accident and discovered a fatality. The normally talkative Swango grew even more animated than usual, often exclaiming, "Wasn't that great?" after they removed a body. Krzysztofczyk thought maybe he was just testing him, trying to get a reaction. But then Swango started phoning him when he missed out on a gruesome call. "What did it look like?" he would ask. "What did you see?" Swango wanted even the goriest details repeated. Another paramedic, Brent Onmissig, relayed a comment by Swango that seemed odd coming from someone who was trying to save lives. Onmissig had been driving with Swango down a busy Quincy street one day when a motorcyclist passed them. "That's my friend," Swango said. "Why is that your friend, Mike?" Onmissig asked. "He doesn't have a helmet on," Swango replied. Swango was so interested in death that he mentioned to several of his fellow paramedics that he'd like to get the job of deputy coroner. Indeed, he approached the coroner, Wayne Johnson, asking for the job. Swango's interest in articles about violent death, first manifested when he was a child, now became an obsession, as he himself described it. Krzysztofczyk and the other paramedics noticed that when Swango was on duty and waiting for an ambulance call, he spent much of his time working on 4 or 5 large scrapbooks. He'd spread out articles on the table and carefully paste them into one of the books. One day, Krzysztofczyk went over to the table and looked at some of the articles. Many were about fatal car crashes, and quite a few about poison. He could tell Swango didn't like him sifting through the clippings. Swango told him that while he was living in Columbus, a cleaning woman had messed up the order of the clippings, and he said he'd blown up at her. Krzysztofczyk took that as a warning. Just to be friendly, Krzysztofczyk mentioned that media magnate Rupert Murdoch had very recently purchased the Chicago Sun-Times, published in Krzysztofczyk's hometown, and he told Swango he might want to subscribe, given Murdoch's reputation as a tabloid publisher. "It's going to have all kinds of lurid articles," he said. Swango thanked him for the suggestion. "How'd you get started on this?" Krzysztofczyk continued. Swango explained that he'd been on an ambulance call in which someone was killed, and the next day he'd seen an article about the accident in the paper. He'd gotten a charge out of it, so he cut out and saved the article. Since then, he said, clipping articles about accident fatalities had developed into an obsession. Krzysztofczyk also asked Swango specifically about why he had so many articles on poison. "It's a good way to kill people," Swango replied matter-of-factly. Krzysztofczyk shrugged. Was that a joke? He never knew when to take Swango seriously. Few things distracted Swango from work on the scrapbooks. But on July 18th, not long after his arrival, the paramedics were watching TV in their quarters when a news bulletin announced that an out-of-work security guard, armed with a rifle and shotgun, had killed 21 people at a busy McDonald's restaurant in San Ysidro, California, before being gunned down by a police sharpshooter. Television crews had rushed to the scene, filming the gruesome spectacle of the dead and wounded, many of them children. Swango was relaxing in a recliner, but at the first mention of the massacre, he leaped to his feet, rushed to the television set, and turned up the volume as far as it would go. "Don't do that!" shouted one of his colleagues, Greg Myers, annoyed at the ear-splitting sound. Swango turned it down slightly, but then, still standing in front of the TV as he absorbed the news, he shouted gleefully, "That's just great! I love it!" When the segment ended, he continued, "I wish I could have been there." He talked about the killings the rest of the afternoon, jumping up every time CNN repeated the news and footage. "Man, you're crazy," Myers thought, but he didn't say anything. "Did you hear about the McDonald's massacre?" he asked Lonnie Long when he came in. "Every time I think of a good idea, somebody beats me to it." The next day, Swango mentioned the killings to another paramedic. "Wasn't that something about that McDonald's massacre?" he said. "I'd give anything in the world to have been there and seen it." Sexual banter wasn't uncommon among the mostly male staff. But there, too, Swango set new standards. He loved to tease the one woman paramedic, Sandy Ivers, who also happened to be dating his boss, Lonnie Long, and later married him. "Sandy, do you know what I'd like to do to you?" he asked her. He then described in lurid detail what he called a sexual fantasy that culminated in his plunging a hatchet into the back of her head. After the first recounting of this fantasy, Ivers would say, "Get away from me, Swango." But he nonetheless repeated it in her presence on several occasions, within earshot of other paramedics. In addition to his visits to Rita Dumas in Columbus, Swango was now dating a nurse at St. Mary's Hospital. While he never confided any details of his actual sex life, he often spoke of fantasies in which violence and sex were closely linked. His fellow paramedics detected a sexual element in his excitement over the McDonald's massacre. He once told Krzysztofczyk that the best thing about being a doctor was to come out of the emergency room with a hard-on to tell some parents that their kid has just died from head trauma. "Mike, you are very weird," Krzysztofczyk told him. To another paramedic, Swango said he'd love to take a gun into the emergency room and start blowing people away. And then there was what he described as the ultimate call. Nearly all the paramedics at one time or another heard Swango recount, with only minor variations, his fantasy of this ultimate emergency. In this scenario, Swango is called to the site of an accident in which a busload of children has been hit head-on by a tractor-trailer filled with gasoline. As Swango arrives on the scene, another bus plows into the wreckage, causing a massive explosion of the gas-filled truck. The force of the explosion throws the children's bodies onto nearby barbed wire fences. Swango would see kids hurled into barbed wire fences, onto the telephone poles, on the street, burning, as Unmissig put it, describing what Swango had told him. Again, the paramedics sensed a sexual undercurrent to Swango's excitement as he narrated the ghastly details of burning children thrown onto barbed wire. Later that summer, Krzysztofczyk and Swango were drinking coffee together, waiting for a call while they watched a public television special on Henry Lee Lucas, who at the time was believed to be the nation's most prolific serial killer. Lucas had just been convicted of the murder of an unidentified woman known only as Orne Socks, the first of more than 20 victims he confessed to killing along Interstate 35 in Texas. In a widely watched television interview, Lucas claimed to have crisscrossed the country with a partner, wantonly raping, robbing, and murdering. As he said on television, "We killed him everywhere there is except one. I haven't poisoned anyone. We cut him up. We ran him down in cars. We stabbed him. We beat him. We drowned him. There's crucifixion. There's people we filleted like fish. There's people we burnt. We strangled him. We even stabbed him when we strangled him. We even tied him so that he'd strangle themselves." Krystalczyk was amazed at how excited Swango was by the program. "Wouldn't that be great?" Swango exclaimed after the interview. "To travel around the country, killing people, just moving on, killing some more. A great lifestyle." Early on the morning of September 14th, Swango showed up at the paramedics' quarters in the hospital with a box of honey-made donuts and put them on the table. Krystalczyk was mildly surprised. It wasn't unusual for the paramedics to bring food to work, but he couldn't remember Swango ever showing much generosity. Usually it was Lonnie Long who brought in donuts or sweet rolls. Krystalczyk had gone along with Swango recently when he stopped by to see his mother. Muriel gave Michael a chocolate cream pie she had baked. Krystalczyk had expected Swango to offer him a piece when they returned to the hospital. Instead, Swango had devoured the entire pie himself. "I got you guys a bunch of donuts," Swango said as he put the box on the table. Krystalczyk took a donut, as did the other three paramedics in the room that morning. But Swango didn't take one. He sat down near the TV. This in itself was somewhat unusual, because Swango usually had so much energy that he stood up or paced in front of the TV while watching CNN. Krystalczyk took a bite. He thought the donut tasted okay, though the icing on it looked as if it had melted slightly, maybe from exposure to heat. It was a warm day for September. One of Swango's colleagues chided him. "What did you do, buy day-old donuts?" "They're fresh. Just bought them this morning," Swango replied cheerfully. About a half hour later, one of the paramedics began to feel nauseated, flushed, dizzy, and had to rush to the bathroom to vomit. Within another 15 minutes, all four who had eaten the donuts were ill with similar symptoms. "What did you do, Mike? Poison us?" joked Unmissig. Swango looked incredulous, sitting forward in his chair and shaking his head earnestly. "No, I didn't," he replied, staring down at the floor as he said it. "You know I wouldn't do anything like that." He picked up the box with the remaining donuts, saying he was going to take them down to the nurse's station. As their condition worsened, the paramedics reported to the emergency room, where they told the doctor on duty that they'd all just eaten donuts and become violently ill. The doctor suspected food poisoning and gave them a drug to retard vomiting. But if anything, the drug seemed to make matters worse. All four had to leave work. The incident was reported to the Adams County Health Department as a case of suspected food poisoning, and two investigators for the department interviewed the paramedics and personnel at the honey-made donut shop. The shop owner was indignant at the suggestion that there was something unhygienic about his operation and personally ate 6 donuts on the spot. The investigators inspected storage conditions and packaging materials, but nothing suggested food poisoning. With nothing more to go on, they concluded that an unidentified virus was to blame, and the matter was closed. Krystalczyk's symptoms hadn't been as bad as the others. He wasn't sure he'd even finished the donut, and he later returned to the hospital. As he got out of his car in the parking lot, Swango materialized. "How are you feeling?" he asked, seemingly genuinely concerned. Krystalczyk said he'd been sick, but was feeling a little better. "How are the others?" Swango asked, eagerly pressing him for details. Swango also called the homes of the other victims, asking relatives or roommates how they were feeling and how their illnesses were developing.
"Niggas will live next door to you, break in your house and come over the next day and go, 'I heard you got robbed.' Because you was doing shit." Dang!
the Katherine Massey Book Club. I feel like it's always appropriate to hear the voice of the preeminent counter or critical race theorist of our times, the legend, Chris Rock. But, I mean, that's like totally different level. It's one thing, no count nigra, break into your house, steal your 100-inch TV or whatever other valuables, abscond, and then come back and they go, oh, heard you got... It's totally different. Poison you. And then, oh, hey, brother, you feeling all right? You looking a little peaked. Oh, man, you hanging in? You sure? Let me feel your forehead. Oh, Lord. And then they say, he called them when they get in. Oh, Lord, brother, you hanging in? You think you're going to be at work tomorrow? Oh, man, you vomited? Oh, my goodness. You think you're going to make it? Let me bring you some soup. Oh, I think I humbly disagree with Chris Rock, just because if you get poisoned, if you die, you might not be able to enjoy the TV that has been stolen. So it might just be a teaspoon worse, poison you, and then come to check on you and bring you soup. Katherine Massey Book Club. Oh, my God. I'm so glad I picked this book. What? Fiction? Fiction? Fiction. Katherine Massey Book Club. The number to dial, 605-313-5164, the code 564-943 pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Number again, 605-313-5164, the code 564-943 pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. The email untiljustice@gmail.com. untiljustice@gmail.com. Now, I've done my diligence. Even I'm feeling way better, recuperated, all that good stuff. Even while I was not feeling well, I tried to do some research in preparation for this text. Lots of material. I told you there are lots of documentaries about Swango and many, many news reports. Big, big paper trail about this case that went on for decades. That being said, I was doing my research, collecting news reports. Now, there's not as much material like Columbine, Jeffrey Dahmer, not that volume of material, but there is a lot about this case. Now, I went to get, this is from July 16, 2000, specifically, that was a Sunday, I specifically went to get the report, Southern Illinois University grad faces death penalty. Talking about old Swango. Now, this is way down the road in the book from where we are, not even reading this right now. I'm only sharing this because I got this today, and this is one of the reasons why it's important to research. You'll learn so much about white supremacy, racism. So this is on the same page of the paper on this day in July 2000. Right next to that article about Swango maybe getting the death penalty, it reads, Mississippi hanging. So the date again on this is July 16, 2000. Bill Clinton would have still been in the White House last few months. Mississippi hanging. This is in, of course, Jackson, where they still had bad water 20 years ago. A computer owned by a black teenager who was found hanging in his front yard is the source of a fight between the victim's family, who believe the teen was lynched, and authorities who want to find out if the computer contains a suicide note. Reynard Johnson was found hanging from a pecan tree June 16 near the front door of his home, hours after showing family members how to use the new computer. The Reverend Jesse Jackson and family members say that and other events prove the 17-year-old honor student was not depressed and contemplating suicide. They believe he was lynched because of his... man. Cowbell. And we will leave that there. But I did this quite a bit, I think, when we read Joey 22 last year, and other reports just, hey, happened at the same time. How about that? Pause for Reynard Johnson, R-A-Y-N-A-R-D, Johnson, Jackson. Mr. Reynard Jackson probably couldn't shower or flush the toilet often either. Okie doke, let's see. We'll share one email and then nab the folks who dialed in. I'll share some of my notes as well. Let's see. Email number one. There we go. Get my... Alrighty. Email number one. Let's see. Okay. Combo, book club, and workplace racism. I felt that often while reading. I recall now when I think I sort of came across Swango during the mid-1980s. I was interviewing for a job in the medical field in Ohio, had my one good suit on, and was nervous but excited, wanting to give my best impression. The suspected white supremacist male opened the interview with, "I'm only interviewing you as a favor. I don't know you. You could be..." Oh, wait a minute. He says, "I'm only interviewing you as a favor. I don't know. You could be like that doctor who killed those patients at Ohio State." And the interview went down from there. Of course. I don't think I said one word during the interview. I had no idea at the time who he was talking about. I was planning to move to Ohio from out of state at the time, and I guess the Swango case was mostly just covered in Ohio, Illinois, too. It remains one of the most profoundly deflating experiences of my life. I still have scars from that interview. I am certain it was double O who he was talking about. Of course, I did not get the job. Rats. I didn't really put it together completely until I started reading the text. Wow. Reading is more important than watching television. But I mean, that's what I said. Like, I think Mommy C... we were talking about that last week in terms of, do we think Swango is well known? And she said, "I don't think so." I was, you know, said, "I'll have to think about that because there's so many documentaries and TV projects and things on Swango. Books, we're reading one right now, and he's mentioned in other books and articles. 60 Minutes talked about him and all the rest of it." But I searched. When I searched his name, I got less than 40,000 hits. You search Columbine, millions. Dahmer, millions. Bundy, Ted Bundy, millions. Charles Manson, millions. Less than 40,000 for Michael Swango. They got tours in the UK for Jack the Ripper right now. That's another one, millions. So some of these killers are substantially older than Swango, some of them more recent. Not that popular. And it reminded me this summer when we had Judith Fatala and Bethan Jones on the program from the UK, both in Wales. They were talking about the popular so-called true crime community, white people, One of them said specifically, you couldn't pay me to be interested or to read about Harold Shipman. It's boring. This is the white doctor in the UK who was doing the same thing as Swango, going around and killing patients. That's boring. I don't want to read about that. That's boring. I want to hear about Jack the Ripper, Jeffrey Dahmer, yeah, sneaking into the room, you know, BTK, I sneak into the house and do all that, yeah, you know, this daring and trick the police and like, yeah, that's something like, that's boring, you know, you just go around and stick a needle in somebody that's, that's boring, you know, that's, where's the thrill in that? Literally, white people said that, where, you know, eh, that's not really, you know, you like a more exciting white killer. Anywho, back to the email. Number one, or yes, chapter three. Swango's accusers were all female nurses, his defenders male doctors. The one female attending physician on the neurosurgery service was Chairman Hunt's wife. Her name does not seem to come up in the investigation. Chairman Hunt's name does not come up either as a major part of the investigation. I would think he should have played a prominent role since he's the one that had to sign off on hiring him. Meh. Make it a collective responsibility. They call it diffusion of responsibility, so nobody here will be blamed. Two, she was dead. Massive blood clot. She was bleeding all over her body, even from her eyes, as if she had been bitten by a poisonous snake such as a cobra. She's dead now. It seemed like it lifted his ego or something. She said of her daughter's death, he just seemed so happy. It's extra spicy chicken. He knew that KFC offered extra crispy chicken, but he never heard of extra spicy. Later, all three fell violently ill. This chapter reminds me of one of those fictional horror films or novels, a.k.a. Stephen King. Living in the global system of racism, white supremacy can be such a horror show, and it's not fiction. Oh my God, for real? Like, Jesus Lord. I have to pause. How could I? Man, some idiot does have a platform neutralizing workplace racism. For many years, said idiot has said, hey, you go to work, no eating. No eating. No eating. We've even specifically talked about, hey, you might want to be cautious about those community refrigerators, potluck, anything of the sort, anything that you eat in the workplace. Hey, I brought this to the facility myself, and I've been watchful. I've maintained vigilance over my vittles the whole time so that no Swango had an opportunity to Swango me. I go to get my food. Incidentally, I say with that, like, man, you put some food. I don't care if you had it in your office, you step out to go to the restroom or what have you, come back and, hey, someone has obviously molested my lunch satchel. They've opened it and moved. That's peculiar, but I'm still going to eat. I'm hungry. We are in the system of white supremacy racism. It's no eating on the job. You bring in food and you know something has happened. Somebody's touched this, messed it over. I don't know. Like, it doesn't seem like there's something on it. There's not a bite or anything taken out of it, but this has clearly been manipulated since I packed and put all this together. If your attempted partner, care mate, whatever, daughter, mom, whomever, if they didn't open it up to add, you know, an extra orange wedge or a slice of avocado for you, napkin, something of that nature. If that didn't happen, in the trash. I have worked on jobs. Now, I haven't worked where anybody, co-workers were poisoning people, but I have worked on jobs where theft of food was very common.
they take half of it, all of it, all of that. That's why I'd say before, like, you got to be careful even about putting food in there, period. But, man, somebody, even if they, like I said, come in your office and get your little lunch bag, take it out, boom, 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 put it back. Don't even play like that. Certainly nothing that they concocted at home. Or they even, now see, I hadn't, that's one I hadn't thought of, where you do the group orders and they go get the food and bring it in. Thank you, Michael Swango. Not doing that either. Only eating food on the job that you yourself, I brought this to the facility. Nothing else, I'm good. I have a job, ostensibly. I should make enough money. I have groceries. I did not come here looking for free crumbs. You got an extra peanut butter sandwich? You can eat your corner? They might have swangoed you. That's what you think about. Oh, I'm gonna go. Oh, wait a minute. Those donuts. Yeah. You brought in chicken? Yeah. I bet it's extra spicy. I'm good. Let's see. Number four. Oh, we didn't get that far. We did get that far. Sorry, we can get that one. Page 76. Three doctors on the university's medical faculty submitted recommendations. Two. Certificates of recommendation were made on a standard form. Dr. Gary Birkin, he rated Swango as excellent, and exemplary. Dr. Carey, the head of surgery, rated Swango as good, but in the space for comments, he said he was recommending Swango with reservations. C reduced Swango's troubles at Ohio State largely to issue of personality, licensed him to practice medicine in Ohio. Cover up, and these are the guys operating on you. You know what they say, surgeons bury their mistakes. They call that Negro humor. Anyway. Incidentally, since he used the term cover up and then had the audacity to say it repeatedly, I said, oh, Gus, he did do my research on this here case. Oh, I had to remind, I posted Sue Klebold. She did tell us about the movie that her and Dill liked was Arsenic and Lace. I didn't watch that movie, but the plot says that that one is also about serial killers poisoning people, burying the bodies in the basement. Anyway, I posted it, the article from one of the Illinois newspapers, OSU cover-up charged in probe of doctor, a former Illinois coroner who investigated the arsenic poisonings of six paramedics has accused Ohio State University Medical School officials of trying to cover up an incident involving the surgeon charged in the poisonings. I posted the whole article on my social media so you can read, but yes, that, and didn't we just hear about that term cover up with Columbine? I think that even came up with Dahmer and all that. Dang, you let this dude go out here doing all this child rape and sodomy for all this time? And you were coming in contact? Yes, cover up. Two, he was immediately hired by the Adams County Ambulance Corps, where he had worked the previous spring and went part-time while he was at Quincy College. Did he notify them of the ambulance job he had in med school, American Sirens, I think it is, where they eventually didn't allow him to interact with patients? Did they even check it out if he did? Probably didn't. He seemed like he was very adroit at deception and faking applications, resumes, so I suspect he probably manipulated that, and to some degree, some of that wasn't even necessary, because we've heard that, you know, these white people in hiring positions, they didn't even do, you know, rudimentary checks, so it could have been a little bit of both, you know, he lies a little bit, and then they're inept in the hiring. Oh, blonde white man, come on in. You brought donuts? Come on in. Three. Lonnie Long, who was in charge of the paramedics and who hired Swango, was a guns and weapons enthusiast. Copies of Soldier of Fortune and the National Rifle Association magazine were often lying about the paramedics' quarters. I work with a lot of white male physicians who are totally immersed in gun culture, some keeping immense stores of ordnance in their homes and bragging about the weaponry they own. A local suspected racist physician ran for political office this year, and his TV ad held an AR-15. He won big. Well, incidentally, that's the gun that they were talking about banning. I love the explanation I saw more recently. They said, which gun is the AR-15? Is it the AR-15? That's the weapon the gunman had at Uvalde, where the officers were so scared they didn't even want to go in the school. AR-15. Mostly non-white children died there, too, 1 year ago. We'll pause there. We didn't get any further than that. Let's see. Email again, untiljustice@gmail.com. Untiljustice@gmail.com. Sprinkle in our emails as we go. Nab some of our callers as well. Let's see. Folks who dialed in who have commentary, line should be open. Proceed. Let's see, caller 1432, are you just listening? Did you have commentary for the book club?
Can it be heard?
Yes, sir.
All right, I just had a few notes about the reading. Found it kind of strange that the Adams County Ambulance Corps was full of gun-crazy people. Made me think that do they really enjoy seeing people in pain, and is that why they picked the profession they were in? The callousness of the doctors, how they treat patients, I've actually had to witness that with my own family, so it wasn't surprising at all about how Dr. Swango would explain to people how their family members had died. The people who he worked with, I don't think they took him seriously enough when he would say stuff about killing people. And when one of the doctors asked him about poison, he responded, "It's a good way to kill people." And the guy said, "Is that a joke?" And I was just thinking, like, how could that be a joke? They said he had a fantasy of dead children being blown up, and he would go around telling people stuff like this. That was crazy. Another thing I was thinking, why would anyone eat anything that Swango brought in to work, knowing how thick his mind was and what he talked about? And people would just eat anything you bring in, I guess. And then another thing I took a note about was how these doctors were consistently misdiagnosing the victims that were being poisoned without even really investigating. I think that that's very common, how they just tell you anything and push you on out of the hospital. I think that's it for now. Thanks for letting me speak.
Much obliged, good sir. I just, with the, you said the, it surprised you, the doctors, healthcare practitioners, their love of firearms, that kind of surprised you. Why would that be surprising, given that we're talking about white doctors? And in this case, I think mostly, if not exclusively, white male doctors. Why would that be surprising?
Well, basically, I just never heard. I guess I just never thought about nothing like that. I mean, now that you think about it, it's really not as surprising as it's just maybe shocking when I first heard it. Like, you know, people who you're taught to think that people who are doctors and stuff want to actually heal people and have a certain demeanor about themselves, but it's just crazy to really get to understand how these people really think.
Thank you for indulging my question, sir. It's, what does it mean to be white? And for sure, with the response that he said, dang, I thought you take the Hippocratic Oath. You're supposed to heal, right? That's the whole reason you go into the profession. That seems kind of contradictory. Then you got AR-15. I'm about here bragging and, like, that, What does it mean to be white? Much obliged, good sir. An excellent point. They will tell you anything. Put that white lab coat on. Oh, yes. Diabetes. Yes. Yes. Anything. Anything. And people will eat anything that you bring in. Now, I have seen that myself. That's why I say we have to get out of that. I guess food is a really powerful motivating force. You really have to get out of that. So they train you, Pavlov and all that. They ring the bell. Oh, we get something to eat. Get something to eat. Pause. Even he said, like, dang, this is the guy that he hops up and, ooh, out the children get burned up and thrown on the barbed wire. Ooh, he got the scrapbook and all that. Like, I am hungry, but you were cheering a little too hard for that McDonald's shooting. I think I'm a pass on those spare ribs. I'm a pass. Yes. I know, as I'm sure it is. But what I told you, you had your excuses ready. I'm fasting, gluten free, vegan. You got peanut allergies. You just rattle them off. Other folks who dialed in, you have commentary to share. Lines should be open. Proceed.
Maddie Hurt.
Fresh princess from Philly. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so a few things. It seems like the other doctors definitely suspected him, but I don't understand why they kept passing him along if they had all of these reservations. I found it interesting how they used the woman's health record against her. And also put in her health record that she hallucinated the whole incident. It seems like the hospitals were more interested in protecting themselves from lawsuits than getting rid of a bad doctor. All the things that he was saying about killing people and dark ideations, I'm surprised no one accused him of making terroristic threats. There was the element of sexual harassment with the woman that he had a sexual fantasy about and then said he was going to murder her. Like, to me, you should be fired when you make those types of statements, but it doesn't seem like anybody really was willing to do so. It's just kind of frustrating because it seems as though everybody knew, but they turned their attention elsewhere and just tried to cover it up. So it's like more like they were aiding and abetting him a little. So those are my thoughts. Thank you for allowing me to speak.
Thought she was going to say that they knew, but they turned a blind eye. I was like, see, James Stewart, like, that's why I named it Blind Eye. See, yes. White people don't get fired. They get transferred. And even that, like she said, you know, it seemed like the white officials at Ohio State that they knew, but they were more concerned about being sued by Swango. It didn't seem that they had a thought like, dang, maybe Rena Cooper could get a Johnny Cochran, F. Lee Bailey, somebody. Maybe she might file a lawsuit that, hey, I told you, this blonde white dude, tried to slip something or did slip something in my IV and you didn't take it seriously. Like, they had no concern at all that this nigga woman, and that is so important. Talked about that last week. Rena Cooper, black female. He doesn't mention racial classifications, at least to this point, at all. I think that is so important that these are white men and white women with white lab coats. And that's specifically Rena Cooper, and even more so when we get to the continent. But, man, to just dismiss her, no thought about her rights or what have you, all about the rights of Michael Swango, and even that's going to be a bigger point that Stewart makes in the book, how these white doctors, he doesn't say white, but that's who it is, these white doctors, they work together, Voltron effect, to look out for each other. We even heard some of that already in the book, where that white fella, they didn't even give his name. I was going to say his name, but I don't have it because Stewart didn't include it. The white doctor with the criminal history of sexual misconduct, he was on a work chain gang, they said, but he still got the position at Ohio State and had it at the time that this book was published. They look out for each other. We don't want these hefty malpractice suits. We're not going to do all this heavy investigating of potential employees and stuff. We want to make it difficult, maybe even for you to get access, you being the general public, to what sort of history does this doctor have? Has he been accused of some Michael Swango type misconduct? Not making it easy to find out that sort of thing. Those are kind of bigger points that all, in my view, all relate back to the system of white supremacy racism, because take what Fresh Princess just said. I said before, if this had been Dr. Francis Cress Welsing tipping around here and suspiciously 00 Welsing shows up, flatline. Like, dang, she just came in, she had tennis elbow, and now she died? Like, what's going on here? And that 00 Welsing was here again. Like, I cannot imagine a universe where it's just, yeah, you know, Welsing might sue us, you know. Gotta keep her on, you know. She has rights, you know. Let her finish out her residency and we just push her on. I cannot imagine what universe. How about Dr. Ben Carson? He tipping around here and mysteriously patients just dropping like flies. What's going on? Old Dr. Ben is always close by with a syringe. We just push him on down the road, let it somebody.
Well, he did get fired from Hopkins.
He got fired from what?
Very low key. So after he made those comments from about homosexuality being like bestiality, they made him send an email from his Hopkins address to all Hopkins employees, but it made it look like he was sending it to you personally, apologizing for his comments and announcing that he would be retiring. And I was, my principal investigator, where I was doing my postgrad research, was in the same pod as him in the pediatric clinic. And the university gave him 3 months to refer all of his patients out. And he was barred from speaking, being the keynote speaker at the graduation that year. So that was like right before he like ran for president, but they very quietly basically asked him to leave.
Black male privilege. Now, maybe part of that, you know, Dr. Carson was tipping around and suspiciously patients were passing away and such, but I didn't hear none of that. It seemed like he was just being an old notorious black male homophobe, which, you know, that's all of us, right? And she said they took immediate action. Decisive, barred him from speaking, and all that old Swango, they didn't even tell everybody about these concerns. Black male privilege. That's why I said I saw a whole lot of reports, pictures. They got whole series. They did Apple TV. It's called Nurses Who Kill. That's it. I just looked to see if Swango was there. I didn't think he would be because he wasn't a nurse, but still. They got a whole series, and it's got seasons. Plural. I'm looking. Are they going to have somebody that looks like Dr. Welsing? Ben Carson? I'm looking because every single one of these medical serial killers classified as white. And it seems like all of the stories are the same. How many people did they get? We don't know. How long did they get to get? We don't know. How long did they get away with this? We don't know. How did they get away with this? Same thing that we keep hearing in this book. Get to some of my notes and then, we got to do the email. Yeah, hurry up, get to some of my notes here. Let's see. Yeah, about the commentary, *61. Let's see. So they go and do this sham investigation. I compared this to, you know, the police when they go out and kill people, but I mean, it's the same thing. They do these old fake investigations. We don't want to make the department look bad, police or the hospital. We got a big budget riding. We got that new oncology wing opening up. Let's just, you know, get this on down the road and shut up these no-count nurses on the grapevine. Now, since he does play up the sexism angle, white male doctors in positions of power, and they discard the white females. Hey, do I think the same thing could have happened if Swango had been Michelle instead of Michael? Yep, because we got Lucy Letby. It happens to be that it's a white male in this case, but I mean for reals. System of white supremacy, you do have hierarchy. Sometimes it'll be set up like this. Sometimes it's not. But at the end of the day, it's going to be people classified as white making the decisions. That's the important part. Matter of fact, with Lucy Letby, it was a non-white male physician who raised concerns about her, and they made him apologize, just like Dr. Ben Carson we just heard about. Apologize to that white woman. You know she didn't kill any children. Shut your mouth. Played the clip in the archives before. Let's see. This is Goodman's principal reaction to the interview seems to have been distressed that Cooper was spreading stories that were agitating other patients. That's why I said I think it's important that Rena Cooper, that you know, readers know, really, Rena Cooper is classified as a black female. This is white doctors saying this nigga woman is crazy. This nigga woman is not believable. She is out here spreading lies and upsetting our patients, and we are going to deal with this accordingly. That is so, so common. And I think even Mama C last week said she thinks that her roommate, Rena Cooper's roommate, she had Iwonya Uza, I think that's how you say it, that Izonia, that she might be a black female as well, because she was also discarded. She's got a brain tumor, defective, you know, Negro brain. You know, she don't know what she's talking about either. Ah! Just dismiss all that out of hand. We don't have to say anything about that. And no concern that either of them would file a lawsuit. They can't even spell lawsuit or lawyer. Let's see. And then all the cronies and the people that are on this, they say, the people who attended the meeting to make this decision, what are we going to do? Holder, Zagornius, and Michael Whitcomb, the hospital medical director, a close friend and protege of Zagornius. See, like I said, we've been hanging out in all of this. We don't want to get each other in trouble. We will look out for each other. We're not going to investigate anybody here and make sure everybody has plausible deniability, and we're not going to the police. It seems like white people can make that sort of decision all the time. They see a black person out walking a dog, and they're ready to call the police. He's ready to rape the whole neighborhood and loot everyone. You got clear evidence. Dang, this Negro might be poisoning people. Oh, Michael Swango, 007. Nah, no need to call. Like, dang. That's kind of Columbine-ish, too. Like, the pipe bombs and everything. Let's see. All this lying in the report where Cooper, she says it was a blonde person. You couldn't see the person's face. Miss Cooper says it was a blonde-haired white person, basically. Who came and did something with her IV, and they changed it to, well, she said it was a female and yellow pharmacist jacket, and she, you know, it can't be trusted. They do all this. I told you, I played the report last week from the Justice Files where she said, Rena Cooper, where they interviewed her, They were trying to put words in my mouth. They come back and say, well, dang, we got a spike. We normally don't have this many deaths over this short period of time. They say, as another doctor put it, sometimes the grim reaper of death just sweeps through a hospital. What is that? That's what I said at the beginning. The Lord works in mysterious ways. Like, what? Rena Cooper didn't say no reaper of death swept through. She said, man, a blonde-haired doctor came in and put something in my IV. Let's see. All of this, I do think it's important because I've said this, we've said this frequently over the year. The system of white supremacy, there is a hierarchy, white on top, non-white dominated. Darker you are, the worse you will be mistreated. Classified as black, double whammy. But even within individuals classified as white, the white race, some whites are more powerful than others. That is very flagrant here. Well, you got these here, this situation, white male doctors, where they have all the power and they can decide, boom, boom, boom. And then the nurses and the staff, it just goes down. But you follow orders, same way that they have things set up in the military. But they set up a lot of these types of structures in the system of white supremacy where it will be a hierarchy. And so the more powerful whites, they make the decision about what's going to happen. Speaking of hierarchy, you even heard as right next paragraph, Swango's file was reviewed and the group discussed the evidence suggesting that he had attitudinal problems. Carey mentioned the residents' reports that Swango had weird ideas about death, that he was fascinated by the Nazis, and that his work was substandard. Now, the Nazi component, we've heard that a lot. Jeffrey Dahmer, Columbine, all the way back to Brazil, black man in Brazilian soccer, where they were doing the same thing. What again should stand out, the substandard work. It's not just that this guy's killing folks. You're not even good at what you do. All that, again, cronyism, nepotism, looking out for white people who are not even doing quality work, and they still can get passed along, transferred, and get prestigious spots. They said he's getting, like, coveted slots at these universities. We only take a select number of students. And then, I'm moonlighting, halfway paying attention, can't identify a heart, and then poisoning people in my spare time. Let's see. And then they take sketchy notes about this. That's been my experience. White people, they can hire a stenographer. If they want to be serious about investigating something, you got a potential death, one of your employees killing a patient, and we take kind of slipshod notes about all this. Okay, let's see. The syringe, that's another one too, where they have all this evidence, particularly now, I mean, dang, where they can go in the lab and say, hey, we can do DNA tests and all this other to come up with exactly what was in this, who touched this, all the rest of it, what would have been the body's response to this sort of chemical, because they can figure out the residue, what was in the syringe to begin with. Let's see. Oh, wait a minute. Whitcomb looked terrible, as if he hadn't had much sleep. That, even you can pause right there. I think we'd had this discussion before about the widespread drug use at colleges. Sometimes it'll start off with just that right there. You have lots of white students in these colleges, and I want to go out and party and do my binge drinking and all the rest of it, fraternity row and sororities and all that on the weekend, and still go to class and cheat and all the rest of it. So I'm going to need some sort of drug so that I can stay up, you know, 3, 4, 5 days in a row. We heard that from Swango. See, he said he only had to sleep like 2 hours. Some people can do that. Some people would need drug assistance to do that. Sometimes it'll start right there. But you have white college students. I'm on my parents' health care plan, so I got great coverage. I can go to the doctor, whine, and get Adderall or whatever other drugs so that I can stay up for 2-3 days with no sleep and study and cheat and do whatever else I want, binge drink, all the rest of it. Starts with that sort of thing right there. They say with Whitcomb, look as if he hadn't slept much. It hadn't surprised anyone that he couldn't be located in time for the first meeting. I don't even have to show up on time. Punctuality, schmunctuality. It was much discussed in the hospital that he had been having an affair with his secretary and was involved in a messy divorce. And then you have the audacity to come around and look at black people and talk about behave yourself and have some integrity and what. Man, get out of here. We messing around on the office, in the empty room, in the back, and this is known throughout the hospital. This hasn't impaired your career at all. Just some grist while we hang out at the water cooler, checking to make sure Swango ain't off to anybody. Come on, and then they continue to say, wait a minute. At the meeting, Whitcomb's hands were visibly trembling. Now, when that paragraph started about him looking terrible and he hadn't slept much, my mind was already at narcotics. I was already thinking, oh, because you got the access right there. If Swango can get all the poisons that he wants, syringes, and nobody's really checking and testing, I'm a doctor. I can go raid the cabinet. They already told us they had the swinging parties. That was like a week ago, right? Known for having the, I said then, uh-oh. They raided the cabinet. If it's going to be that wild and raunchy, and then all the sex talk that we did, come on, come on. And then he later publicly acknowledged that he had a drinking problem. That's probably an unacknowledged drug problem in there, too. Oh, that's how we got in the opioid situation, too. Let's see. Yeah, they say Cooper's not reliable. She doesn't know what she's talking about. You know, all this nonsense. Let's see. They say, she's so niggerized in their statements. They say that was the end of Whitcomb's report. As Hunt later summed up the evidence, all we have is a crazy patient who had an unusual episode, a nurse who saw something that isn't enough to prove anything. That is so niggerized. Like, you probably just had a seizure and don't know what you're talking about anyway. And, you know, no, nothing to see here. Moving on. Dickinson being the one person who seems to have a problem with this and think that, you know, Swango may have actually tried to kill her, but she's not listened to. As it, they point out the gender component of all of this, leaving out these are folks classified as white, and Rena Cooper is a black female. They say Swango, Dickinson felt it would now be impossible to observe Swango closely in the hospital. There was too much to do and too few doctors who had been alerted to Swango's suspicious activities to keep him under close surveillance, especially if the nurses and most of the doctors were kept in the dark. The language of white supremacy, racism. White people are supposed to be informed, intelligent about things, and informed in a timely manner. It's the dark people who are kept in the dark, where we don't know, not even Rena Cooper. She probably didn't even get a copy of the investigation about how she was almost killed. Let's see. And then Dickinson saying that this was so bad, she was afraid to go out. She thought she might be killed. Imagine that. I work with people that I think might kill me. That is the case for some of us. Let's see. Oh, and then the nurse, Carolyn Berry, she puts her lunch on the job and thinks that he might have poisoned it. I think she's totally correct. As I said, I've talked about this for a long time. You're not eating anything on the job. If you bring your lunch, I've said, hey, you can keep it in your car. If you drive to work, you can keep, especially now that's going in the wintertime, probably getting cold enough in most areas, you can keep your lunch or what have you in your car for those 4 hours or what have you. It'll be cold enough outside that it'll be fine. Then you can go get your food, eat it, heat it up, whatever you need to do, and you'll be great. You can leave it in the trunk, whatever. Or they have portable refrigerators that are not cost prohibitive. They are super light, convenient, where you could easily have your food in there, and then you can take it with you to your work area, whatever the case. You can even go low-tech. They have great coolers now as well. You can do the same thing. Leave it in your vehicle. Bring it in if you have a workstation where you can have it where you work directly. Keep an eye on it and all that. But I would not leave food around. You could be poisoned, fondled, stolen, all of the above. You don't know. Let's see. They moved Swango after all this. Swango completed his general surgery rotation in April, moved to the Children's Hospital for his pediatrics rotation. I had to read that about 15 times. Wow. White people do not care about children. And then they end chapter three with Rena Cooper is crazy, unstable, paranoid, niggardly. Let's see. Anything else? The wording of how they explain Swango. There was a suggestion concerning a patient's demise with regards to Dr. Swango having been in attendance proximate to the demise. This was investigated rather thoroughly, and Dr. Swango was exonerated. Like, that is really jargon. We talk about that all the time, deceptive, where white people lie sometimes by just omitting and or not being direct about it. Like, that is quite different than saying he was accused of killing this patient, where at minimum administering a substance in her IV when he was not authorized to do so, and she didn't even need it. At minimum, that's closer to the charge that was made, as opposed to, it's not even accurate. She didn't die. I mean, it's just to be that deliberately vague and not in sync with the facts of the event, that is another way that white people skillfully practice deception so that you don't get an accurate sense of what exactly took place with all of this. You're just left with, huh? He did, but he was exonerated, so okay, I guess. Yeah, I guess he's, and he gets that, like, that's the sort of thing that I submit, if this had been Dr. Ben Carson, 00 Wellsing, they would have been direct. This nigger was accused of murder. Like, I could be wrong. If you find a Negro medical serial killer, we'll compare. I haven't found one yet. I think we'll pause there. Oh, they included the Mississippi River when Swango moves back to Quincy to work on the paramedics with all his Negro humor. We heard that again, that the Mississippi River is experiencing like historic lows, drought right now. I don't know if that's impacting them up in Illinois, where the Mississippi River port is, but I did just see that within the last few days, like historic lows for the Mississippi River. I guess you chalk that up to climate change as well. We'll pause there. We will pick up with chapter four. If you dialed in, wrote in, we'll get everything. Second audio segment. The Katherine Massey Book Club, Context of White Supremacy, James B. Stewart, Blind Eye, Section 2.
The next evening, a Friday, Swango was assigned to work at the Quincy Notre Dame High School football game, where two ambulances are always on duty in case of injuries to players. Swango was assigned to the backup ambulance rather than, as he preferred, to the primary emergency vehicle. Swango's alma mater, Christian Brothers, had merged with the private Catholic girls' school in Quincy, and the combined schools used the name Notre Dame. With marching bands, cheerleaders, and enthusiastic students, the football games were festive occasions that attracted large crowds. Swango had once marched with his clarinet in the halftime shows. Swango's partner on the ambulance that evening was Brent Unmissig, who was in his 20s, easygoing and popular, especially with nurses. With a twinge of envy, other paramedics sometimes teased him about his good looks. Unmissig was still feeling sick from the donuts and had barely been able to make it to the game after his violent illness. The game was proceeding uneventfully when, just before halftime, Swango offered to get Unmissig a soda. Unmissig said he'd like a Coke. Swango returned with a cola in a paper cup and gave it to his partner, who took a sip. He'd drunk about half the cup by the time halftime began and the players left the field. Soon after, Unmissig felt a renewed wave of nausea. He sat the cup on the spare tire of the ambulance, ran behind the vehicle, and vomited. When he returned, he noticed the cup was gone, though he was too ill to care. By the end of the third quarter, he was again vomiting behind the ambulance and suffering severe stomach cramps. He had to go home. Unmissig lived with his aunt, Connie Meyer, who worked as a secretary in the emergency room. The next day, Swango called her to see how Unmissig was doing, asking whether he'd have to miss his next shift, and probing for details of his symptoms. Suffering from an intense headache, continued nausea, and dehydration, and Missig couldn't get out of bed for 3 days. Gradually, the others, too, recovered and returned to work. 12 days later, on September 27th, several of the paramedics teased Swango over the fact that he'd been assigned again to the backup ambulance rather than the primary emergency vehicle. This seemed to infuriate Swango, which only encouraged them to keep up the banter. Swango, in turn, had been complaining that the other paramedics weren't keeping up with reading the latest literature on emergency medicine and weren't working hard enough. A little after noon, after responding to an ambulance call, Swango said, "I'm going after some sodas. Does anybody want one?" "Yeah, I'd like a 7-Up," replied Greg Myers, who hadn't eaten any of Swango's donuts. After a few minutes, Myers saw Swango coming down the corridor with 4 sodas. But then Swango turned suddenly into the men's bathroom. When Swango handed him his 7-Up, Myers noticed that it had already been opened. "Hey, what the heck did you do?" Myers asked jokingly. "Go in the bathroom and take a whiz in mine?" "What do you mean?" Swango asked. "I saw you go into the bathroom," Myers said. "No, no," Swango said, explaining that he'd opened the 7-Up by mistake. Though the can seemed full, Myers noticed the residue of some liquid around the opening, and again teased Swango about having urinated in it. "I wasn't feeling well," Swango said this time, explaining he'd taken a sip of the soda to settle his stomach. "That's fine, as long as you didn't whiz in it," Myers laughed. He poured the 7-Up into a cup filled with ice and drank about a fourth of it. Soon after, he started to stand up, then suddenly sat down, overcome by nausea. He rushed to the bathroom, where he was racked by vomiting, the worst he'd ever experienced. While he was in the bathroom, Swango came to the door holding the cup of soda and asked if he wanted more, saying it might settle his stomach. Myers declined. He was so weak, he had to lie down. He couldn't even drive home. Someone else had to replace him on the shift. When Myers' girlfriend, who worked at the hospital, stopped by later that afternoon, he told her, "Something's not right. I never get sick like this." She asked him what had happened, and he told her he'd just drunk some 7-Up that Swango had gotten for him. She mentioned that she'd just passed Swango in the kitchen area, where he was emptying a cup and ice into the sink. Myers suggested she look for the can. She found it in the sink, upside down, drained. About an hour later, Myers managed to drive himself home, but had to stop 3 times to vomit en route. That evening, he got a call from Swango, who asked how he was doing and wanted to hear about his symptoms in great detail. Did he have diarrhea? How long had it lasted? Had his headache grown worse? Myers felt that most people would have asked how he was doing and left it at that. Swango was a doctor, but his interest seemed so acute that when he hung up, Myers said to himself, "I think he gave me something." Several days later, when he had recovered enough to return to work, Myers described the incident involving the 7-Up to Connie Meyer. Her eyes widened as she listened to his story. "Oh, my God," she finally said. "That's just what happened to Brent at the football game." The pattern seemed obvious. Swango had offered both Unmissig and Myers a soda just before they fell ill. But Myers and Meyer were reluctant to share their suspicions. When Myers mentioned them to Lonnie Long, the boss brushed them aside, dismissing as preposterous the notion that someone like Swango might have tampered with their drinks. Nevertheless, the two confided in another paramedic, Fred Bennett, who thought they might be onto something. About 2 weeks later, on October 12th, while Swango was on duty, 2 other paramedics brewed some iced tea, then left on a call. They each took a sip of the tea when they returned. Both preferred unsweetened tea, and they hadn't added any sugar, but inexplicably, the tea tasted very sweet. Alarmed by the recent spate of severe illness among their fellow paramedics, they poured out the glasses and began searching for any empty sugar packets that might explain the sweet taste. They found none. Swango, hearing their remarks, dumped out the entire pitcher of tea. Later that afternoon, after Swango had left on an ambulance run, the two noticed that his duffel was open and a bag stamped George Keller and Sons had fallen from it. Keller is a large garden and feed store in Quincy, and when they looked in the bag, the paramedics saw two boxes of Taro brand ant poison. One of the boxes was empty, the other contained a full bottle. The primary active ingredient in Taro ant poison is arsenic, which is concentrated in a sweet sucrose solution. When they shared this discovery with Krzysztofczyk, he went to the emergency room and looked up arsenic in the medical encyclopedia. The symptoms of arsenic poisoning, violent vomiting, stomach cramps, and severe headaches were exactly what they had been experiencing. Now several of the paramedics baited a trap. They had been careful to keep their suspicions confined to a small group. Krzysztofczyk, Unmissig, Myers, Fred Bennett, Connie Meyer, and a few others. They didn't want anyone tipping off Swango. First, they planted some fake ambulance calls that would summon everyone from the paramedics' quarters, leaving them vacant. Swango would hear the calls on his scanner, they assumed. Someone in the emergency room would surreptitiously watch the paramedics' room to see what he did. But nothing materialized. Then, about a week later, on Friday, October 19th, Myers brewed a pot of iced tea, adding no sweetener. He and Bennett poured the tea into their glasses, which were marked with their initials. They had taken just a few sips when they received an ambulance call, put the glasses down, and left. Not long after, Swango drove out of the parking lot and stopped at a busy intersection. Another paramedic pulled up just behind him. Suddenly, as Myers and Bennett approached in their ambulance, Swango pulled over, threw his car into reverse, and backed up at high speed until he could turn into the nearest alleyway. Curious, the paramedic who'd stopped behind Swango's car at the intersection returned to the hospital, where he told Myers and Bennett about Swango's strange behavior. Unaware of the recent developments, he said laughingly that it seemed Swango didn't want them to see him. Myers and Bennett looked at each other knowingly, then went to their tea. Bennett took a taste. "Taste this," he said to Myers. Myers took the glass. "Damn, that's sweet," he said. Shortly after, Mark Krzysztofczyk arrived. "Here," Myers said, handing him the glass of tea. Krzysztofczyk tasted it. "We've got him," he thought. But now that the paramedics had the sample of sweetened tea, none of them knew what to do with it. They poured the remaining tea into a plastic container they obtained from the emergency room, then put that inside an empty cottage cheese container and stored it in a brown paper bag in Bennett's locker. At 2 a.m., Swango showed up at St. Mary's Hospital, where one of his closest friends among the paramedics, Lamont Monty Grover, was on call, sleeping in the paramedics' quarters. Swango woke him and insisted Grover walk outside with him into the hospital garage. There, Swango said, "Sometimes I feel I have an evil purpose in life." Grover didn't know what to say. The paramedics left the tea in the locker over the weekend. When they told Connie Meyer about it, she called Dr. William Gasser, who, in addition to having been one of Swango's chemistry professors at Quincy College, also worked part-time helping the pathologists at Blessing Hospital as a laboratory consultant. Meyer told Gasser she had some tea she'd like tested for the presence of arsenic. Gasser said he couldn't test specifically for arsenic, but he could do a relatively simple test that would indicate the presence of heavy metals. Arsenic is a heavy metal, along with cadmium and tin. Gasser knew only that the liquid was tea. On Monday, he took the sample to his lab at Quincy College. First, he tested ordinary tea, which did not show the presence of any heavy metals. Then he tested the sample. It was positive. Myers took the sample to the Adams County coroner, Wayne Johnson, who forwarded it to the crime lab at the Illinois Bureau of Investigation for further tests. It was positive for arsenic. Armed with this evidence, the group of paramedics, along with Connie Meyer, met with Gene Mann, the director of the Adams County Health Department, in his office. They shut the door and laid out their findings. Noticing their absence, Swango asked several secretaries at the emergency room what was going on, but none of them knew. At the meeting, several paramedics, Krzysztofczyk among them, argued for more time to collect evidence. They knew Swango was smart and cocky, and they were afraid he'd wriggle out of any charges unless they caught him red-handed. But presidential candidate Michael Dukakis was scheduled to arrive in Quincy for a speech at the college later that week. Swango had been talking recently about assassinations, and they worried that such a prominent visitor might be at risk if Swango remained at large. The paramedics had the feeling that Swango had merely been experimenting with them, though the arsenic dose in the pitcher of tea might have been lethal to anyone who actually consumed it. But they felt that their evidence suggested that Swango, far from the all-American image he projected, was psychologically twisted and fully capable of murder. Mann decided that the police should be notified immediately. He picked up the phone. Swango seemed suspicious that so many of the paramedics had been meeting with Mann, but when he asked what they were doing, Myers claimed it was nothing important. Swango badgered him. "What were you talking about?" he asked. "Nothing I can tell you about," Myers replied. The next day, Friday, October 26th, Swango got a call at work asking if he'd stop by the Adams County Sheriff's Office. He had applied for the deputy coroner job. Sheriff Bob Nall implied that he was about to get the job. When Swango arrived, he was instead arrested, read his rights, charged with battery, which under Illinois law includes non-fatal poisonings. Though he said he wouldn't make any statement without his lawyer being present, he gave the police permission to search his apartment. When police arrived at the neat, two-story house on 18th Street and opened the door to Swango's apartment, they were startled. The place was a mess. Spread out on a table and shelves was a virtual poison lab, with a large book bearing a skull and crossbones on the cover placed prominently amid the vials, needles, and bottles. The book, The Poor Man's James Bond, which is said to be popular among paramilitary enthusiasts, is described by its publisher, Paladin Press, as the undisputed leader in the field of books on improvised weaponry and do-it-yourself mayhem, which tells how to buy most of the needed chemicals from your grocery and garden store. As the police report described the scene, an entire mini-lab setup was observed. Detectives found numerous chemicals, suspected poisons, and poisonous compounds. Underground-type magazines were observed that gave technical information on exotic poisons. Handwritten recipes for poisons, poisonous compounds were observed. The poisons and recipes included ricin, botulin, nicotine, supersaturated cyanide, and fluoroacetic acid. The report continued. Detectives also observed numerous newspapers and various scrapbooks, etc. The suspect appears to have been collecting information on disasters, car accidents, and even newspaper clippings in regards to the Tylenol murders in the Chicago, Illinois area. The police seized as possible evidence the James Bond book, various pesticides, including numerous bottles of taro ant poison filled to varying levels, chemicals, a large supply of castor beans, the raw material for the poison ricin, syringes, needles, and a gallon jug of sulfuric acid. The police also confiscated a small arsenal, a Mossberg 12-gauge pump shotgun with a combat stock, a Lama 357 Magnum revolver, a Raven 25 caliber automatic handgun, and two large K-bar survival knives. But perhaps the most peculiar items dealt with the occult. Among the books confiscated were the Book of Ceremonial Magic, the Necronomicon, and the Modern Witch's Spellbook. Police also found numerous handwritten spells, incantations, and a bag of stones bearing peculiar markings. Mostly out of curiosity, the police also checked with the Quincy Public Library. The library's records indicated that Swango had recently checked out two books. One by One, a novel by Linda Lee, and The Healer, a true story of medicine and murder by Leonard Levitt. According to its jacket copy, One by One describes how a pair of diabolical psychopaths injects botulism toxin into the food in New York City's supermarkets, terrorizing the entire city's population. The Healer is a nonfiction account of the 1975 fatal injection of his wife with Demerol by Charles Friedgood, a Long Island surgeon. According to its jacket copy, it is a fascinating psychological study of a physician murderer. News of Michael's arrest stunned the extended Swango family. Muriel Swango was staying in Florida with her son Richard when Michael called Friday afternoon to say he'd been arrested for battery and needed bail money. Muriel called Michael's aunt, Ruth Miller in Quincy, and asked her to go to the courthouse and put up the $5,000. Muriel promised to repay her as soon as she returned. Swango was released that evening. Muriel also called Bob in Oregon to tell him about his brother. She was matter-of-fact and unemotional. When Louise Scharf heard the news in Springfield, she called Ruth for details. "It's all a misunderstanding," Ruth explained. "Michael told his mother it was some kind of fight." But on the Monday after Swango's arrest, the Quincy Herald-Whig ran a brief story that made no mention of any fight or brawl. The headline was, "Man Suspected of Poisoning Co-Worker." Michael W. Swango, 30, 220 North 18th, was arrested Friday on a charge of aggravated battery in connection with the earlier poisoning of a co-worker. Police Chief Charles A. Gruber said investigators are still trying to learn the exact nature and content of the toxic pesticide. The toxin is being checked at laboratories in Chicago and Atlanta, Gruber said. Muriel returned to Quincy immediately after hearing the news. Ruth asked her what had really happened. "He's not guilty at all," Muriel said. "How can you say that?" Ruth asked. "Because he told me he wasn't," she replied firmly. Chapter 5. The Ohio State University Police Department occupies spacious quarters near the football stadium, and with 50 officers is larger than the police force in many medium-sized cities. Police Chief Peter Hurt, who was 40 at the time of Swango's arrest, reported to a university vice president, and though the force often cooperated with the Columbus police, it was autonomous. Indeed, Hurt had been personally assured by President Edward Jennings before he agreed to take the job that he would have unfettered freedom to investigate any crime. So when Quincy authorities called the Columbus police asking for background on Swango, an Ohio State intern, they were referred to the Ohio State force. OSU police officer Bruce Anderson returned the call. The Quincy police briefed him on Swango's arrest and on the bizarre evidence found in his apartment. This was hardly the usual fare for a university police officer, even on a campus the size of Ohio State. Anderson, age 34, had a bachelor's degree in microbiology. He had minimal experience in major crime investigation. He went to the hospital and was told to speak to the chief of surgery and met with Dr. Carey on the afternoon of October 26th, the same day as Swango's arrest. Coroner Wayne Johnson had also phoned Carey earlier that day, but Carey thought he was calling about a job recommendation for Swango and ignored the call. That was why Johnson had turned to the police for help. Anderson now told Carey that Swango had just been arrested in Illinois and that he was pursuing a background check for the Illinois authorities. Carey was taken aback. He had largely put Swango out of his mind in the 4 months since the intern had left Ohio State and didn't remember much about the internal investigation. He refreshed his memory by looking at Swango's file. Carey told Anderson that Swango's performance as an intern had been substandard and that he hadn't been reappointed at the end of his first year. He added that Swango had been accused of tampering with a patient's IV line. The hospital had conducted an internal investigation, he said, and Swango had been exonerated, the same language he'd used in recommending Swango to the medical board. Anderson thought Carey cooperative, though he didn't show the officer Swango's file, since it included confidential evaluations of his performance. Carey did tell Anderson that Swango's personnel file should be available in the office of the acting medical director. The possible import of the news from Quincy wasn't lost on Carey. As soon as Anderson left, he called Zagornis. Apparently unrelated to the Swango incident, Whitcomb, the medical director who conducted the internal investigation of Swango, had taken a leave of absence. And Cramp, the hospital's executive director, had resigned. Zagornis, in turn, consulted University Vice President Richard Jackson and Alphonse Cincione, the outside lawyer brought in for the Swango investigation. This suggests that Zagornis immediately recognized the potential significance of Swango's arrest. Zagornis called a meeting to discuss the latest turn of events. The group included, for the first time in the Swango affair, someone from the hospital's public relations office. The focus of the meeting seems to have been to limit the legal and public relations damage to the Ohio State hospitals. Concern was expressed about the confidentiality of files, Swango's and patients. Consideration was even given to issuing a press release, since word of Swango's arrest in Illinois was likely to surface publicly in Ohio sooner or later. But that impulse was quickly suppressed. There is no indication that anyone decided to notify the Ohio State Medical Board that Swango had been arrested. Later, it was concluded that someone involved, probably Dr. Carey, should have alerted the State Medical Board. Instead, the upshot of the meeting was that Assistant Attorney General Holder, who had been involved in the earlier investigation and was therefore familiar with the facts, should handle all police inquiries as well as any others. Specifically, no files relating to Swango or patients would be given to the OSU police by anyone at the hospital. In keeping with the hospital's policy, they were moved to a locked file cabinet, to which access was strictly limited. The possibility of cooperating fully with a police investigation, and perhaps finally getting to the bottom of the Cooper incident, not to mention the patient deaths, doesn't seem to have been discussed, even though it was a police officer's request for cooperation that had triggered the meeting. The decision to position a lawyer between the university police force and the hospital doctors and other personnel, in particular to use the same lawyer who had already exonerated Swango and endorsed the decision to return him to hospital duty the previous February, was surely based on the perceived need to protect patient confidentiality and to limit any potential liability and embarrassing publicity. But it may also have reflected a long-standing deterioration in relations between doctors and the police at Ohio State. Similar tensions developed in many American communities during the preceding decades of malpractice litigation and skyrocketing insurance premiums. Many doctors had come to see the police as little more than evidence seekers for plaintiffs' lawyers. The hospital administrator's defensiveness also reflected doctors' concerns that the police, in their zeal to find and convict criminals, were insensitive to the well-being of patients and the workings of the hospital, which they seemed all too willing to disrupt. In the case of Ohio State, ill will between doctors and police had reached the boiling point during a recent investigation within the hospitals. As a result of a spate of reports of gambling and loan sharking at university hospitals, the OSU police had mounted a relatively sophisticated undercover operation, using investigators posing as hospital employees. Evidence soon emerged of drug abuse at the hospitals. Fiber optic cameras were mounted inside, several of them being trained on carts used to store and dispense drugs. The agents obtained footage of doctors, nurses, and nurses' aides taking drugs from the cart. In some cases, they injected themselves with narcotics intended for patients who needed relief from pain, then replaced the drugs with a saline solution given to patients. Investigators observed one doctor who was obviously drunk while on duty, and others who appeared to be working while under the influence of marijuana and other drugs. Chief Hurd took the evidence to Holder, the assistant attorney general now involved in the Swango inquiries, arguing that criminal activity was far more widespread in the hospitals than anyone had suspected, and that the investigation should be expanded. Holder sent Hurt to the university's Risk Management Committee, which aims to reduce liability. Hurt was later told that hospital personnel suspected of drug and alcohol abuse should be quietly encouraged to seek treatment, but that no other investigative steps should be taken. The surveillance operation was later dismantled. No drug charges were ever filed. Still, as word of the operation spread within the hospitals, many doctors became angry. They thought the OSU police had been trying to entrap them, and this generated even more distrust of the force. The police, in turn, were angered and made cynical by their perception that the hospitals were more interested in covering up any possible liability or embarrassment than in stopping drug and alcohol abuse in the hospitals. With these recent tensions still simmering, Holder and Jackson called Charles Gams, the university administrator who oversaw the police force, and asked him to find out exactly what the police were doing in the hospital. Gams, in turn, called Chief Hurt. Hurt, with his rugged good looks, prematurely gray hair, and forceful presence, was viewed by some as overqualified for the university job, not to mention overzealous. He was nationally known in police circles for his work in the 70s on the Oakland, California police force, where he investigated the Symbionese Liberation Army kidnapping of Patty Hearst. Since then, however, his career had become somewhat less exciting. He had come to Ohio State from comparatively peaceful Springfield, Vermont, where he had been police chief, and the university assignment seemed to make up in job security and benefits what it lacked in drama. For that, Hurd turned to his own imagination, writing crime fiction for Police magazine. He had just arrived at OSU, and it wasn't yet clear whether he'd be a team player, someone who was equally sensitive to the safety of the community and the reputation of the university. When Gams called, asking what Officer Anderson was doing asking questions at the medical school, it came as news to Hurt. The Quincy police request for a background check on a former student had seemed inconsequential. Anderson hadn't bothered mentioning it to Hurt. Hurt spoke to Anderson, then reported back to Gams that they were simply doing a routine background check at the request of the Quincy police force. But the suddenly expressed interest of an assistant vice president naturally alerted Hurt and Anderson to the possibility that the matter was less routine than Anderson had assumed. This was confirmed the next day. Anderson returned to the acting medical director's office, expecting to review Swango's files, and was informed that they had been moved to Zagornis's office. As had been decided at the previous day's strategy meeting, Anderson was told to direct his inquiries to Holder. Instead, Anderson went in person to Zagornis's office to see the Swango files he thought he'd been promised. He was told to wait. After some time passed, Zagornis's secretary told him he had a phone call from Holder, which Anderson assumed meant that someone at Zagornis's office had called the assistant attorney general. Once Anderson got on the phone, Holder asked him what he was doing there. Once again, Anderson explained the nature of the inquiry and said he simply wanted to review Swango's personnel file. Holder told him he could not get that information from Zagornis, and suggested that he and Anderson meet to discuss the matter the following week. Anderson returned to headquarters empty-handed.
Wow. Katherine Massey Book Club. Now, I don't know about you all, but wow. This book has gotten so much better as we have gone along. Wow. James B. Stewart, Blind Eye, the terrifying story of a doctor who got away with murder because he was classified as white and had lots of powerful white people to aid and abet. Didn't I say that word hierarchy? You have more powerful white people. The number to dial, 605-313-5164. The code 564-943 pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. The number again, 605-313-5164, the code 564 943 pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. The email, untiljustice@gmail.com. Untiljustice@gmail.com. Email number two, Lauren writing in, hello, Gus and callers. I've been unable to call in, so I've typed up some notes to share. First, I'd like to say that I think it was inconsiderate and even mean-spirited of Swango to let his mother and aunt get on the highway and drive to see him graduate, knowing that he wouldn't be walking across the stage. From what I've read so far in the text, Swango seems to practice deception with ease. But I just can't imagine how hurt and embarrassed my mother would have been if I allowed her to do such a thing. I guess this is what we're reading these books for, to help contrast and compare the way these people think, speak, and act with the way that we non-white people do. Chapter 3. Number 1. At the beginning of Chapter 3, it talks about Dean Richard Moy making sure that Swango's dean's letter was carefully written to inform the reader that he hadn't graduated with his class, that he'd been required to repeat a rotation that he had failed, and that there were concerns about his professional behavior. And yet, on March day in 1983, Swango was chosen for a residency, in neurosurgery that 59 other people applied for. The author isn't saying it, but I wonder if Swango is falsifying documents to get accepted for these residencies. Why was he chosen over all the other candidates? I think the document falsification, if it hasn't been stated explicitly, it is going to come up in the text. Stay tuned. At the time Swango was hired, no one from Ohio State called anyone at SIU. Indeed, no one appears to even to have noticed that he should have graduated from SIU a year earlier than he did. Number two, the investigation that Ohio State Hospital did not seem like it was intended to reveal truth. Goodman interviewed one patient, Ms. Cooper, black female, and then it appears that he lied about what she said. Ms. Cooper insisted that she never described her assailant as female, nor did she ever mention anything about a yellow pharmacy jacket. Goodman did not interview Miss Cooper's roommate, any of the residents, the nurses, the orderly who discovered the syringe, or any of the witnesses of the patient's deaths. No autopsies or physical tests were ordered for any of the possible victims, and no toxicology or anesthesia experts were conducted. He then moved Miss Cooper to a private room and ordered that only one nurse could attend to her. I doubt this nurse was on duty 24 hours a day, so I have no idea how that worked. Her IV line had been discarded, so no tests on it were possible. Curiously, the mention of possible tests on the IV line triggered no mention of the syringe by Goodman, although he had been told of its existence by Nurse Moore. The group concluded that the cause of Cooper's seizure was probably unknowable. The Lord works in mysterious ways. That lady didn't even have a seizure. She told these people that she deliberately shook the bed rails to get their attention, but that's just negra gibberish, you know. Number three, Swango's file was reviewed, and the group discussed the evidence suggesting that he had attitudinal problems. Carrie mentioned the residents' reports that Swango had weird ideas about death, that he was fascinated by the Nazis, and that his work was substandard. Okay, I thought about this, and it seems like a lot of white people are fascinated by the so-called Nazis, and they think about death-making in a much different manner than the rest of the people on the planet. True. At this point, the way white people devalue life and worship death, it's just starting to seem typical. Yep, white culture. Number four, Swango gave like three different stories. He wasn't in Rena Cooper's room. He was in the room, but only to give her slippers. And Whitcomb later told the police that Swango said he was in the room to draw blood. Why were his inconsistent stories accepted as credible and other people's reports dismissed as incredible? Now, hey, I submit maybe the only factor to explain that you really need is Rena Cooper is a nigra. And, like I said, some of the folks said we think her roommate also is a nigra. Enough said. Five, on the afternoon of February 20, Mary Popko came to visit her 22-year-old daughter, Anna Mae, who had undergone intestinal surgery for a deformed bowel. She was sitting with her daughter when Swango asked her to leave the room so he could give Anna May an injection to raise her blood pressure. Popko asked to remain so she could hold her daughter's hand. Swango refused, and she reluctantly left the room. Later that afternoon, Swango summoned Popko to a small conference room. He leaned back and put his feet on the table. "She's dead now," Swango said of Popko's daughter. "You can go look at her." Let's see. Despite Carrie's warning, none of the residents who had been alerted about Swango reported anything unusual. "If a doctor said he was going to give my family member a shot to raise their blood pressure, I think I would ask some questions. For example, what is her blood pressure? What do you think her blood pressure should be? Why hasn't anyone else talked to me about a blood pressure problem? What medication do you plan to use? And why can't you give her this injection in my presence? People usually want to do incorrect things out of the sight of others, and he seemed so casually dismissive about the whole thing. I mean, he put his feet up on the table before he told that lady that her daughter was dead. The arrogance of it all. And that is exactly what Vernelia Randall told us way back in the first year of the COWS. If you have to go to see those white people in a white lab coat, or really any doctor, healthcare provider, get someone healthy to go with you who is in their correct mind. They don't have to be a doctor, a registered nurse, none of the above. All they have to do is ask those types of logical questions. Can I stay here to hold her hand? Why not? What problem will that cause? Me being here to hold my child's hand and have them, you know, explain it. That doesn't require a PhD for you to explain why I can't be here. I might need a second opinion. In fact, call security and tell them that I can't be here to hold my daughter's hand for you to give a shot. Let's see. Just asking quick, because sometimes that white lab coat, that's exactly what Vernelia Randall said. They think I can just come in and bully and intimidate you, especially you're some old nigger. Like, oh, shut up. Shut up. You don't know what you're doing. Shut up. I don't have to explain anything to you. Just get out of here. Shut up. That's all. No. Just ask questions. What we talk about, what we do on this program all the time. Just asking questions calmly. I'm not yelling and cursing, jumping up and down. Just what would be the problem with my presence? Continuing. And none of the residents reported anything unusual. Is this the sort of thing that the author is referring to with the title of his book, Blind Eye? Usually when I hear the title, it's in the phrase, turn a blind eye, but that phrase implies action. It implies that something is seen and then ignored. Blind eye by itself just means an eye that doesn't see, and that does not accurately depict what's been going on so far in the text. It seems like a lot of people who would be classified as white saw that Michael Swango was acting in an incorrect manner, at least suspicious, right? And most of them did not do anything to stop it, and some of them actually helped Swango to continue harming and killing people with their support of him. 6. This book is making me really nervous about eating and or drinking in the workplace. Number 1, I feel like a failure because Gus T has been saying that for years. But hey, what did Fuller say? The genius, he say, white people can show you better than I can tell you. You don't want to be messing around just gobbling up any old thing. And hey, I'm so glad we're reading this now. It's holiday season, so we just got Halloween. That's reason enough right there, because it's already sweet, right? They got the Snickers and the Butterfingers and all that. Like, oh, Lord. They put the ant poison on that. I don't even know. We're getting ready for Thanksgiving and Christmas. People want to bring in pies and cookies and muffins, turkey and soup, all the pot. You got Michael Sweat. Oh, yeah, those donuts. Yeah. 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 say this book is making me really nervous about eating and or drinking in the workplace. Swango is poisoning fried chicken, etc. If I bring my own food, it could still be tampered with. Hang my head in shame. Again, that's one that we've talked about on neutralizing workplace racism for years, even giving out those suggestions, some of them for years, that, yep, can be tampered with even if you bring it in. That's pretty widespread, too. Even white people tamper with other white people's food. So, hey, that's what we read in the book. Nom, nom. Poisoning doctors who had to perform surgery also put the patients at risk. What if vomit got into a person's body while their body was opened up in the operating room? 7, in answer to the question about why the book started in Africa, maybe it's just a storytelling device. Maybe the author was trying to begin at the ending. That way it can come full circle metaphor. A lot of books and movies do this. Mike Swango appears to have started all of his killing in the so-called United States and probably had to go to Africa when white people in this area of the world would no longer hire him. I'm not sure about this as I haven't gotten to the end of the text. Now that is true, but I said specifically because it's a lot of ways that he could have started on the continent, right? He starts specific, and I mean the first paragraph, with a white man putting a needle in the anus of an African male. Why is that the jump off, right? Because he could have started with him trying to get into Saudi Arabia, or it's lots of ways this could have started, but wow, that is, or I might be being goofy. Chapter 4, number 1. But just 5 days after the letter rescinding Swango's residency appointment, 3 doctors on the university's medical faculty submitted recommendations on his behalf to the Ohio State Medical Board, to which Swango had applied for a permanent license to practice medicine. What? So they're okay with him killing people as long as he does it at another hospital? Yes. Fuller told us, genius, white people don't get fired. They get transferred. And it seems like several folks said that, like, just get him out of here. We don't know if he's killing. He might be. We can't prove it. Some of us even think that he's a pretty cool, blonde, blue-eyed white man. So, whatever. Get on down the road and, you know, we'll make sure. And we don't want to be sued. And I think, period. White people, Voltron, white people look out for other white people. They don't have to like each other and what have you, but that's just, hey, we are a minority on the planet. We will look out for other white people. 2, Krzysztofski, I think that's it, close to it, also asked Swango specifically about why he had so many articles on poison. It's a good way to kill people. Swango replied matter-of-factly. Krzysztofski shrugged. Was that a joke? He never knew when to take Swango seriously. Again, with so-called jokes in the workplace, I think we should pay attention to the jokes people tell, because a lot of times they're actually just valid concerns. White people mostly tell the truth when they are joking. 3, few things distracted Swango from work on the scrapbooks. But on July 18, not long after his arrival, the paramedics were watching TV in their headquarters when a news bulletin announced that an out-of-work security guard shoots up the San Ysidro, California McDonald's. 20 or 25 years ago, when I thought about mass shootings, I just didn't understand how common they were. When Columbine happened, it seemed like a new problem that I was seeing on TV. I did not grasp what a fundamental part of white culture that it was. And Swango's comments after seeing the massacre on TV really revealed his true thoughts. Also, the book said that television crews had rushed to the scene, filming the gruesome spectacle of the dead and wounded, many of them children. So the way the news reporters acted after Columbine wasn't new either. No, not at all. They just had much better media. CNN existed, much bigger operations and all of that. In fact, they have lots of footage about that McDonald's shooting because of Columbine. I've just seen it in Pat. They have lots, whole big documentaries, lots of footage. White people don't care about children. 4, when Swango watched the television special on Henry Lee Lucas, whom I was not familiar with, me either, it sounded a lot like natural-born killers. Lucas claimed to have crisscrossed the country with a partner, wantonly raping, robbing, and murdering. As he said on television, we killed him in every way there is except one. I haven't poisoned anyone. Ha, ha, ha. We cut him up. We ran him down in cars. We stabbed him. We beat him. We drowned him. There's crucifixion. And they go, that a white. Well, I bet they got lots of documentaries and books on this guy, too. We'll pause there. Let's see. Folks who dialed in with a hand up, if you have commentary to share, we'll nab Mama C, Woke Baby, non-Clemson grad, since we haven't heard from them.
Can I be heard?
Yes, ma'am.
Hello, Gus. Hello, Cal's listeners. Just a little comment about today's session. We found another situation where Swango retaliated against his fellow coworkers when he was working as a paramedic. He was kind of like demoted from the main ambulance to like some sort of secondary ambulance. And in order to regain his position on the main ambulance, he had to take out his competitors by poisoning them. So if you poison enough of your coworkers, they'll be calling in sick, they'll be absent, and they won't be able to take those calls and be able to serve the community. So, you know, whether it be iced tea, chicken, 7-Up, Coke, donuts, watch out for workers trying to sabotage you. The nurses at the hospital, they were discouraged in pursuing the accusations against Swango. It said Moore dropped the syringe into the waste container. It mentioned that the nursing staff feared retaliation from Swango, like they feared walking alone at home or walking their dog or whatever, being alone. And I suspect that everybody knew what was going on with Dr. Swango, but because they felt like he would retaliate against them, again, they wanted to promote him or transfer him elsewhere so that the problem would go away. But it didn't. Swango had an obsession with, you know, the incidents, like car accidents, and so he, even though he was a doctor and he was practicing medicine, for some reason he was an EMT or paramedic with the Quincy Ambulance, and he had his own radio to be able to monitor the ambulance calls, and with that recent shooting and mass murder in Maine, the guy, I guess he had a radio where he was able to listen to police calls. So that's probably something about white supremacy, where they are obsessed with being informed. And so they have access to the technology to be able to get as much accurate, timely information so they can make better decisions, more informed decisions. And Swango was very obsessed, and he had unrelenting focus. He was addicted to death, trauma, tragedy, gore, intensity, and he was addicted to that rush so much that he studied basically like the 24-hour media circuit to get off or get some sort of rush, like sexual rush related to death and violence. And lastly, the paramedics, just like the nursing staff, they discovered direct evidence that Swango had poisoned the paramedics. One of the people, they researched the ant poison and the symptoms of poisoning. And they, you know, medical staff, they had this evidence, the sample, and they had no idea to send the sample to the toxicology department in the hospital. So I just thought that was really strange. I mean, eventually the police got access to that and they sent it to a lab. But I was just like, are they in so much disbelief that they didn't know what to do with the poison sweet tea. And with that, I will end my share.
Much obliged, Mama C, that is such a great point about the retaliation. She had brought that up last week, like, I'm going to get back at these folks for messing me over. And we got several of those, even with the nurse, where he hit her lunch off as well, back when he's in his residency at Ohio State University. And then again, on the ambulance crew, like, you knock off, like you said, you knock off enough of your colleagues, and, you know, they don't put me on the prime time ambulance run where I can see all the gore that I want to. Enough people call in sick, got no choice. And he said they were picking on him too. Like, that's so Dylan, right? That's so like, they picked on me. They razzed me about it. And they said he got, when they saw that upset him, they did even more of it. So childish. They did even more of it. He said, I'll fix your wagon. Oh, I brought everybody chicken. What does it mean to, that's what everybody should think about that now. At work, people bring in food, white or non-white. Spicy chicken, huh? I'm good. No, I'm good. I'm fasting, holiday season. Yeah, I got that Ozempic too, so I don't, you know, that's a new one too. I'm on that Ozempic. I eat about once a week. Let's see. Our caller, last four digits, 1432. Did you have additional commentary, sir?
Have you heard?
Yes, sir.
I just wanted to get that question about why the author started off with how he did. I was going to say that's probably to keep the white readers excited and engaged from the beginning. They appreciate reading and hearing about non-white people being abused. It's kind of like saying, you know, you don't want to miss this story because, you know, this is what this is going to be full of. So that's it. Thanks.
Fascinating. Fascinating. That is good, particularly if all of this sexual innuendo in the workplace that apparently Swango engaged in and some of the other doctors and medical workers, hey, that's what they say, right? You got to get something hooked, like, ooh-wee, what is in store for you in this book? All righty. Let's see. Get a few of my notes in here. Loretta Lynch, former Attorney General of the United States, first black female Attorney General of the United States, she becomes an important person in the criminal prosecution of Michael Swango. She is not mentioned in this book. Now, this book was published in 1999, so I have to check the timeline of, you know, when exactly she got involved and all of that, but I was stunned. They have lots of archival footage and documentation and what have you, but the great Loretta Lynch did get involved in the criminal prosecution of Michael Swango eventually, even though she's not going to be named in the text. Let's see. Oh, I got too far ahead. Okay, backing up into chapter 4. The poor man's James Bond. I had that, already had a picture of that. That, as they read, is just like the Anarchist Cookbook. You can get it online. In fact, oh, it is so Wellsing. I posted the front cover of the book. It literally has a nerdy-looking white person. And when I say nerdy, this is not like, you know, some bodybuilder, bulging muscles, really huge. It looks like a Dylan, a Reb. And it's got some white woman, and he's got a firearm in a phallic position, a la Dr. Wellsing, and it's got the skull and crossbone. It's got different posters, but the first two editions, and there are many editions, but the first two editions are pretty much something close to what I just gave. You can check social media. I'll post it again, or you can look yourself. I'll post it again on my social media, Twitter, and all the rest of it, but it is so Wellsing. Let's see. Let's see. Oh, the whole testing of the tea. I told you, the Smithsonian, right, history museum operated by white people, they have an entire documentary series. This is like one episode. The series, I think, is like 10 episodes. It's about 10 episodes. One episode in the series is about the history of poisons, and it is wrapped around Michael Swango, and they give you the whole narrative of this case, and specifically the history of detecting if a person has been killed by poisoning and how they developed the technology and refined the technology to detect arson and having to exhume bodies and all. I mean, it's fascinating, but all of that is wrapped around the Michael Swango case specifically. It's fascinating. You can check it out, but they go into more detail about that. Let's see. I thought it was fascinating, the paramedics, so when they put this trap together to get this tea sample, they are very careful not to tell everybody in the workplace that they're going to do this, because you might have snitches, right? You might have a leak, as they say, so they want to keep this tight. That is such codification. If you don't want someone to know something, hey, don't tell anyone at all. They have their operation. These are the only people. We are not sharing this willy-nilly, so that there's no chance that he figures out what we're doing here. Codification. Let's see. Oh, my God. Man, we have done, I think I just brought this up with the great Sue Klebold, Ohio State alumnus. She said she got all those amazing narratives about different people who urinated from the roof. We heard different people saying, you know, oh no, I never, you know, urinated from the roof. No way. I'd never do such a thing. And I said, how much urine has come up so many times in the book club. I said, Richard Williams, Chris Kyle, so many times on the book club, Madiba, urine, continue adding to the list. Now, come on. Somebody, hey, I'm parched, my brother. Comrade, could you grab me a 7-Up? Oh, sure, brother, no problem. They go, and en route to giving my soda, you pause and run into the bathroom. That right there. I'm good. Even if it wasn't open, I'm good. What the world? Why do you... Who takes food beverages into the lavatory? What part of the code is that? Much less you bring it to me open. Like, even if you hadn't gone into the bathroom, like, I'm a grown person, or trying to be. Like, I don't need you to open my beverage. You gonna cut my food for me too? Like, what's going on here? That's another one. You just, I'm good. Dump that out. I'm good. But much less, I gotta ask, repeat, did you whiz in this? No, seriously, did you whiz in? What is going on? I can't believe you drunk. I gotta ask 3 times. You sure you didn't whiz in? Like, no fooling. For reals. You didn't whiz in? What is going on? What is going on? I can't even. Woo. Let's see. Jesus Christ. And we get the same thing. We get the Chris Rock again. So he whizzes in it, basically. And he gets sick, and he did whiz it. And so he drives home, has to throw up on the side of the road and all this. He calls him, oh, man, brother, you doing all right? Oh, no, I didn't whiz that. No. You doing all right, though? Man, what's the symptoms? You threw up? What color was it? Vomiting? Nausea? Sweating? Really? You think you coming in tomorrow? You going to miss? Oh, okay, well, I get on the A-squad. Like, what is going on? Got another P word I said that was going to come up again. Psychopath. Let's see. Took a whiz. He had to ask him like 15 times. They had to go and prove that the donuts had not been tainted at the shop, and the brother had to eat 6 donuts to prove. I said, wow, that is a lot of sugar. You can eat Ozempic or either insulin one. Like, man, you do not need six donuts in one setting. Let's see. They got the T. Poor man's James Bond. They got the Ohio State Police Department is near the football stadium. I said, that sounds like the Philadelphia Eagles, because they got so much rowdy and unscrupulous criminal activity around those football games, alcohol and drugs, that you got to have law enforcement right close. I think they call that the horseshoe. Isn't that it? At Ohio State Buckeyes, they got so much hooliganism that we got to have enforcement authorities close by. You know, things get rowdy. Let's see. Oh, my God. I had to switch up my highlighter coloring. I'm so glad we read this book. The hierarchy again. So now the white people, when they get word that, they're doing a background check on who? Swank? What? He's been arrested for poor. Oh. All right. Huddle. We get together. Like, okay. We get together. Now, what we got to make sure we don't get in trouble. We're not going to throw anyone under the bus. Metaphor. Let's see what we do. Okay. We will hide the file. Yes, that's what we would do. Aiding and abetting? I said, in my view, you got a criminal investigation. Attempted, or they call assault and battery, but he's poisoning coworkers. You could have killed somebody. Somebody's, plural. Hippocratic Oath, same thing. These are doctors, right? White lab coats, same thing. Powerful white doctors. At an institutional level. Let's do the right thing. Hey, that is obstruction of justice, right? Let's do the right thing. Let's help out with this investigation. If we drop the ball, this is a teachable moment. We can, forget that. Look at here. Okay, this is what we're going to do. We will stash the files in a secret vault, and no one will know the code. Agreed. What? Come. And they do this sort of thing all the time. That's what we heard with the Harris family, with Columbine. We shall never speak of these events again. Agreed? And you never heard a peep from the Harris side of the family. Done. Talking about Eric Harris. Codification. See that repeatedly where white people, we can keep things really sealed. We set our bait to catch old 00 Swango for the paramedics. We don't tell everybody. We think this might look bad for the Ohio State University. Shh. Police officer comes in here. No, sir. No, sir. You just don't have that. This is locked file, buddy. I'm sorry. You'll have to go someplace else. And that is that. Oh, my God. I had to get you up. Wait a minute. I had to get the dust off of my shoulders. Oh, my God. Did not Gus T. Renegade? Did I not just say in the last chapter, they start to, oh, trembling hand white doctor. Say, uh-oh. People thought. That was Dr. Whitcomb. They didn't think he was the good one to lead up this investigation, cheating with the secretary and all this, admits to an alcohol problem. I said, that's probably drugs. So you got all these wild parties and all the rest of it. I said, rampant drug use at the I said, all that way before. I hadn't read this book before. I do try to keep up with the news, hopefully learn a little bit about what's happening in the world. Whew. We just had that broadcast about the white drug laws and racism and all that. How did we get here with the so-called opioid crisis and fentanyl and all of that? As a result of a spate of reports of gambling and loan sharking at the university hospitals, the OSU police had mounted a relatively sophisticated undercover operation using investigators posing as hospital employees. Evidence soon emerged of drug abuse at the hospitals. Fiber optic cameras were mounted inside, several of them being trained on carts used to store and dispense drugs. The agents obtained footage of doctors, nurses, and nurses' aides taking drugs from the cart. In some cases, they injected themselves with narcotics intended for patients who needed relief from pain. That's the opioid crisis right there. Then replaced the drugs with a saline solution given to patients. Didn't we just have someone say, with all this white malfeasance and deception, criminal activity going on, isn't this compromising the safety of the patients? Yes. So what? Let's see. And these white doctors have so much power, they shut this investigation down with nary an arrest. That is not privilege. That is white power, and that's exactly what we heard in Colorado, like, repeatedly. In fact, identical. We had Steven Singular on the program, and we talked specifically about major heroin operation in the Denver area. No arrests. Powerful white people. And the same thing with Dale and Reb. They got all that special treatment. No felony arrest. Diversion program. What does it mean to be white? Let's see. Get in that email and then we can wrap up, I think. You can't even get the police officer in the investigation. You can't even get access to the file. The best that you can hope for is a lunch meeting where we explain to you, hey, can't have the university look bad or have any other white officials be investigated behind all this Swango foolishness just because maybe he poisoned Rena Cooper, Negro female. Blah, blah, blah. Maybe he gave them some poisoned donuts, but hey, we got Buckeye football this weekend. Got to beat those Wolverines, so we can't mess that all that up. You know, get on out of here. We're not cooperating with no background investigation of Swango or what he did here. Go Buckeyes. Let's see. Email we did not finish. Let's see. Email number one, last portion. Then we can wrap up. Let's see. The Swango's beaver cleaver all-American looks. He graduated from the University of blonde-haired, blue-eyed, suspected racist. Should be list it on their CV. Like, for real, so many people make mention of that, for real. Just put that as a credential. Number 5, page 80. That's my friend, Swango said. He doesn't have a helmet on. Swango replied, asked why he had so many articles on poison. It's a good way to kill people. Did you hear about the McDonald's massacre? He often spoke of fantasies in which violence and sex were closely linked, narrated the ghastly details of burning children thrown onto barbed wire. Henry Lee Lucas, who at the same time was believed to be the nation's most prolific serial killer, is the message. We found this behavior a little extreme, but not that concerning at the time. That kind of talk in a healthcare environment, at the very least, should get a warning from his superiors. Just more white culture and the celebration of violence, I guess. Really, it reminded me of Columbine again. Isn't that what we heard with Dylan Reb, where it was the same, and I mean literally the same thing? They talked about killing people all the time. Fascination with Nazis and gore and guns and violence, Pulp Fiction, that was all the time. Did you find it a little odd? Well, we all, who doesn't have a pipe bomb? Isn't that what we, that's what I said then? Like, no, there's nothing strange or abnormal about this at all, because this is white culture. That's why he just kept getting transferred. Really, that probably even contributes to why he did all of that. You go into the bathroom. We didn't even get to... Did you wash your hands? Oh, well, I'm thirsty. And then I go, like, come on. Let me get back to the notes. Six. The two duffel was open and a bag stamped George Keller and Sons had fallen from it. Keller is a large garden and feed store in Quincy, and when they looked in the bag, the paramedics saw two boxes of taro ant poison. Arsenic, paramedics baited a trap. I'm not so sure I agree with playing Sherlock Holmes by these characters. I think it could have backfired on them. What if he poisoned one of them enough to kill them while they are amateur sleuthing? Now, I agree with that totally. Yeah, because somebody else, you have no idea if something happens and some. Yeah, that's probably an excellent point. Number seven. The next day, Friday, October 26th, Swango got a call at work asking if he stopped by the Adams County Sheriff's Office. He had applied for the deputy coroner job. Sheriff Bob Nall implied that he was about to get the job. When Swango arrived, he was instead arrested, read his rights, charged with battery. The evidence they obtained from his apartment, albeit circumstantial, it seems overwhelming in enforcing his guilt. I will be interested to read what his defense lawyer uses as an excuse. Circumstantial. Everybody white has the anarchist cookbook. Everybody has ant poison. That's it, basically. He's just a nice white man. Nobody saw him kill everyone. All they have is smoke and mirrors and circumstances and this goofy book. That's all they got. And people who got a flu or stomach flu or what have you or whatever. Chapter 5, number 1. Zagornius called a meeting. Limit the legal and public relations damage to Ohio State hospitals. There is no indication that anyone decided to notify the Ohio State Medical Board. No files relating to Swango or patients would be given to OSU police by anyone at the hospital. They moved to a locked file cabinet, cover up by the white authorities, just like Columbine. For reals. I said so much overlap. It's disgusting, too. Ohio State, ill will between doctors and police regarding gambling, loan sharking. I just read that. Would love to have learned more details about the loan sharking. Me too. Does the gambling include betting pools for the NCAA basketball tournament, which I have found to be quite common and openly performed in some hospitals? And that's OSU. Their sports program is enormous. This is a university with a student body of approximately 50,000, probably give or take 5,000 either way. Just the huge Big Ten football, basketball, all of that, millions of dollars, probably at this point hundreds of millions of dollars, billion-dollar endowments. So it would not surprise me at all. Money laundering, especially if you got all that nefarious drug activity, money laundering. Oh, my God, if you got homies at the hospital, Jesus Christ. Oh, my God, we got the, I can't even imagine. That's another reason why Mike Swango, oh, yeah. It's not exactly like we are doing the correct thing. I'm back here smuggling opioids and hooking up my friends and doing, taking half of the supply for the party on the weekend and hooking up with the secretary and all the nepotism and hiring. So it's not exactly like we are on the up and up. And the racism, forgot to include that, my bad. So, I mean, I could see how an environment of non-justice, yeah, anything, once nobody is interested in doing the correct thing, well, hey, right on to Mike Swango. Let's see. Hurt asked to see Whitcomb's report. The OSU administrators replied that there was no written report, and Whitcomb kept no notes. I am not shocked. See, I said that's another pattern, because these are potential murders. Someone could have been killed. Many dozens. We don't even know how many people died. And for that, when it comes time to, we think Orenthal James did something, and remember they did that whole documentary, Don't F with Cats? Them seeing a video of a cat being killed in God knows where, we got the sleuth and hunt on our free time and take days off work. You got potential people being killed by a healthcare practitioner. Take kind of shoddy notes, huh? Don't want to have anything incriminating written down. Like, come on. What does it mean to be white? I'm so glad we're reading this book. If anything, we should have read this book like a long time ago. Like everybody, you should be thinking about this at work. Don't eat anything that your coworkers bring in, white or non-white. And you want to try and stay out of those hospitals if you can. But man, you get somebody there who is healthy, who cares about you like a teaspoon? Just ask questions. Don't let them be sticking stuffy clothes in the curtain up and, oh, yeah, we just got to check your blood pressure really quick. Yeah, we got to close the curtain. Yeah. Get on right from that. You don't need anybody to see this. Do this in private. Let me see what you're up to. In fact, explain to me what you're up to and why you're doing this. Just asking questions. Oh, my God. Fiction? Fiction. We'll be here tomorrow neutralizing workplace racism, which I feel like we had a lot of that today. Sobriety would be best under conditions of white supremacy. You got Michael Swango at the hospital. Then they're just, oh, he was on crack. You can't believe it. Negros, you know, he was on crack. I smelled the St. Ives on his breath when he, yeah, you can't, yeah. Playing with your Ivy. Get on out of here, you narcotic crackhead Negro. Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. Cow signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim, your brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my condition. Mm-hmm. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.